Okay, we are recording.
All right, meeting of the Protection and Welfare Committee for Monday, December 12th, 2016, in City Hall Room 207 is now in session. Let it be noted for the record that all are present, Alder Zima, Alder Dorf, Alder Galvin, and myself, Alder Scannell, are here. I'll take a motion for approval of the agenda.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Alder Dorf to approve, seconded by Alder Zima. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That is approved. I'll take a motion to approve the minutes for November 28th, 2016.
Motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Motion by Alder Galvin, seconded by Alder Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That also passes. We are on to the meat of the agenda. Number four. Consideration with possible action on an appeal by Alex Beard to the denial of his operator license application. Staff.
City Attorney's Office recommends approval of the appeal. The police department initially denied the application based on the applicant's criminal record, which I am passing out copies now. However, the City Attorney's Office does not believe that the convictions are substantially related to the license activity, and therefore we would recommend approval.
That's correct. We discussed this today with the Chief of Police, and he's in agreement that we would recommend not denying it, but approving it.
Move to approve.
Move to approve by Alder Dorf?
I would like that to be that motion that based on the recommendation of the police department, we move to approve it. I don't want to take ownership of this all by myself.
All together now.
Okay. Based on the recommendation of the police department, I move to approve.
Motion by Alder Dorf to approve, seconded by Alder Zima. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Now, everything we do here is just from a recommendation to the City Council, which will be meeting 2 weeks Tuesday. I don't remember the date. I should write that down.
Is it the 21st?
21st. Well, not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday at 7 o'clock. In the room right next door. So, item number five, consideration with possible action on an appeal by Rebecca Tomchak to the denial of her operator license application.
That's the 20th.
Oh, the 20th. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
The City Attorney's Office recommends denial of this appeal based on the applicant's criminal record, which was passed out for your review. We believe her fairly recent offenses are substantially related to the license activity.
And the police department would agree with that. That would be to continue with recommendation of denial.
Is there anyone here for this item?
Move to open the floor.
Motion by Alder Dorf to open the floor. Seconded by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Second.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, the floor is now open. We just come up and state your name and address, and then just address me no matter what, who's talking to you or whatever. And.
Rebecca Tomchak, 416 3rd Street, Apartment B, O'Connor, Wisconsin. I'm here for the denial of my license. I am aware of my criminal history, obviously. A mistake I made, not a mistake, a bad choice that I made 8 years ago. Served my time, served my probation, paid everything off. It was a gambling addiction. I sought treatment, haven't gambled since. I've been licensed and bartending in the town of Eaton for the last 4 years. And I am applying for a Green Bay license to help out a friend who is managing a bar in town here. And that's where I'm at. She's here too.
Did you also wish to speak?
Oh, sure.
Your name and address, please.
Dee Dee Klug, 3330 Wiggins Way, Green Bay, Wisconsin. I've known Becky for years, and she is very honest and trustworthy, and I am very comfortable with her bartending in my bar. I worked with her in Eaton also, and she is Brian's right hand at the bar in Eaton, and I wish you would approve her to help me out.
Any questions?
Yep. So you don't need this, from what you're telling us. You're requesting this license so you can help her out. It's not something you need to get to make your life better or
well,
get by
money
or
helps. Yeah,
well, I mean without it you're not going to be evicted or lose your car or anything else like that? Okay, and have you, you said you sought treatment for your gambling addiction? Do you have any proof to that effect?
I'm not with me, but I could get it.
Okay, because the thing is, I understand...
I was discharged through a counselor.
Okay, and you've completed your probation?
Yes.
All right, you have any paperwork to that effect?
Not with me.
Okay.
It was, I completed probation a while ago, so it was a 3-year probation.
Well...
3 years, 30 days in jail.
From 2014?
No, it's the second page.
No, 2008.
That's the felony.
Okay. And because part of this is, once we grant you the license, you're not just bound and can only work at her establishment, it's any other establishment in Green Bay. I'd be more comfortable if I could see something showing that you've put some effort into working with your issues and that you've, you know, trying to stay on top of.
Okay, yeah, I can get the paperwork.
Are you suggesting we delay this, or I'm sorry, I'm trying to clarify.
Just hang on, Elder Zimmer?
Go ahead and get it first.
Okay, what are you suggesting?
Well, my motion would be to approve it pending her bringing in some paperwork to the clerks or the council or whatever we deem appropriate.
Thank you for clarifying.
Elder Zimmer?
Okay, well, I would go along with that. I had just thought, you know, we can restrict it to one location if they got to come back in, or can we not do that? That's, in other words, her employer, and that says, speaks loudly to me, but the employer is willing to give a person a chance, then why wouldn't I be willing to give the chance? But if they move to a different location, you know, maybe that proprietor doesn't understand the background or anything like that, and I would want them to come back so that we have a letter from that employer knowing that they're willing to give them the work, knowing the record, because I think that's important. But so, I mean, mine would be to work at this operation, and that any other operation, they'd have to come back with the approval of their boss.
Well, in the past, legal has always counseled that once they have it, they have it, and they can go anywhere. We could, I don't think there's any legal restriction for them to.
Well, I believe we can put a restriction on it. I guess I just defer to staff because I know we've done this in the past, but you know, maybe laws have changed or something.
Right. The state statutes provide that once a license is issued, it's valid within the entire municipality, whether it can be restricted to one particular location. I'm not aware of. We'd have to look into that. But the statutes do say that once it's issued, it's valid within the entire municipality. You can't go to another municipality with that license. It wouldn't be valid there, but it would be valid within the city limits of Green Bay.
What if I would agree to the provision of working in?
We tried to do this, and I've been on for 2 years now. In the past 2 years, we have tried that, and we were counseled that that's not possible. But we could certainly look into it again.
Our attorney said they're not sure about it.
we can look into it if necessary.
I know we have done in the past, but you know, maybe we can get that information before the council.
Well, or she just brought it into staff's office prior to the council meeting?
Just to the clerk's office.
Yeah, just the clerk's office, and it was forwarded to us. Would that suffice? I mean, that gives her till the morning of the 20th, really. I mean, that wouldn't be an issue for you, would it?
No.
Right.
I'm not talking about that.
No, he's talking about restricting her to one location.
I don't know how we can supersede state statute, but...
Well, and I don't know how, I mean, if she moved on to something else, how would we even know? Unless...
Well, I believe stipulations can be done. That's just my sawmill lawyer of 41 years here, so I don't know. I know we've done it in the past, but, you know, maybe some laws change or something. I haven't been on this committee for a few years now. But I did serve about probably 15 to 20 years on this committee. But I could be wrong. But I thought it's worthy to protect the public. In other words, if something goes wrong here and they go somewhere else, maybe we should know about it.
Well, there are many cases where we wanted to do that, for sure. It's a good thing if we can do it. Perhaps, since you're amenable to it, we could put that as a stipulation, and then by Tuesday, we can get legal clarification of whether it actually sticks or not.
I believe that you can give license with conditions on them. But like I said, I would be wrong.
Well, what motion would we like to make?
Well, I think we make a motion to, I think, what was Mr. Galvin? Did you make a motion?
I'd like to move to close the floor first.
Because I was in support of that.
Oh, yes, you're right. You're right. I'm sorry. Thank you. Thank you. Anything else?
No.
Okay. Motion to close the floor.
Second.
Motion by Alder Dorff to close the floor. Seconded by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, the floor is closed. It's back up amongst us. What motion do you wish to make there, Alder Galvin? I believe you did make one.
Right, my motion would just be that if she can bring into the clerk's office paperwork showing that she successfully completed a treatment program for addiction and that she successfully completed her probation and parole, I'd be happy with granting her license to work at any establishment.
Second. Okay, motion by Alder Galvin, seconded by Alder Dorff. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, that carries. So those conditions are, if you don't bring that by the 20th, then your license would be denied.
Okay, so do I still come to the city council meeting?
That's up to you. It's possible someone might pull the item and want to discuss it, and then you might want to be there to present your side. That rarely happens, but it does happen. So it's really up to you.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And then maybe we can just check on that other for future reference.
Yes, noted.
Item 6, consideration with possible action on an available Class B combination license by Karaoke Mexican Restaurant at 418 South Military Avenue. Staff?
City Attorney's Office has no objection. There's no legal basis to deny. It's essentially up to the discretion of the committee. You may deny for any reason or no reason, so long as your decision is not discriminatory or arbitrary, but we have no objection.
And the police department does not have an objection either.
You concur?
I concur.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion to approve by Alder Dorff, seconded by Alder Galvin. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, that motion carries. Item number 7, consideration of possible action on an application for a Class A combination license by Quick Trip Inc. at 515 West Walnut Street.
We skipped one.
Well, you have a different agenda.
That one different?
Oh.
The Noble Roots.
That's the one that was here. Let's see. This one might be. That's odd.
Okay.
There's one in between this.
Yep, mine didn't have it. So.
Yeah, agenda was wrong.
Yep, my agenda's wrong. My apologies. Let's go back to the official item number 7. Consideration with possible action on a Class B beverage and Class C wine license by Noble Roots Brewing Company, LLC at 2790 University Avenue. Staff.
City Attorney's Office has no objection, pending completion of the bar plan and approval from the police department.
I concur with that. I searched the various entities that are involved in this business, and we came up with nothing negative on there at all.
Move to approve.
I have a few questions.
Well, is there anyone here for this item?
Motion open the floor.
Yeah, motion open the floor.
Well, second. I thought we were passing.
Well, he has a few questions.
I'm sorry.
Yep. So motion by Alder Gavin to open the floor. Second by Alder Zima. All in favor.
Or in flavor?
Yep, well, it's a flavor of the month. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the floor is now open. Did you first speak, Dave? Okay.
Yeah, maybe I could just paint a little bit of history on this before we do have the applicants here. This is something that is not in my district. Actually, it's right across the street from my district. It's in Alderman Moore's district, and it's very close to Alderman Dorff's district. Earlier this year, there was a request before the Planning Commission to grant a conditional use approval for this this building to operate as a craft brewery, a very small craft brewery. There was a lot of work done with the Neighbors Association, it's the Schmidt Park Neighbors Association, as well as the residents in primarily in Alderman Dorff's district and my district. I believe the residents are all quite comfortable with it and excited about this as a gathering place in their neighborhood. This is an old gas station at the corner of University and St. Anthony that has gone through a number of uses over the years, and it had some issues with prior uses that have affected the residents. So it was nice to find a use that the residents, you know, after asking a lot of questions, agreed to. They do not need a license from the city to sell beer in the tap room of a brewery, of a craft brewery. But what they are looking to do is to also sell wine, and they'll also be selling other non-alcoholic beverages as well for people who don't prefer the beer. So I think it's a reasonable request, and we do have people here who would like to speak on it or answer your questions on it.
Do you have the date?
No.
Okay. Yep. Okay. If you could please step forward, give your name and address, and then just address me as the chair, please.
Hi, my name is Jordan Sullivan with Noble Roots Brewing Company, LLC. We're at 2790 University Avenue.
But your address, home address?
My home address is 2620 Sage Drive, Green Bay, Wisconsin.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, okay. Dave did answer part of it when he said the reason you're asking for this because you want to serve something other than beer.
Correct.
My other question is, if I remember correctly, it was kind of an odd triangular shaped lot.
Yes.
Is there going to be enough parking by ordinance
yes,
for what you're going to do?
Yeah, there are, I believe, 20 or 21 stalls on site, and I know that was part of our process with the Planning Commission as well, and they had signed off on that plan. I believe that was back in June or July. That they were comfortable with our ratios.
Okay. And they signed we've got a sign.
That's in the works. That will be done this week. That was a part of the stipulation that we would recommend approval with that stipulation.
That
approval
upon
the
stipulation that we
bar,
get the approved plan.
We're correct. Mm-hmm.
By council meeting.
Yes, definitely.
All right. That's all I had.
Okay.
Thank
anyone
you.
Else? Anything you care to add? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Motion to close the floor.
Motion to close the floor by Alder Dorff. Seconded by Alder Gavin. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay, the floor is now closed. What are your wishes?
Again, move to approve, but no one had seconded it.
Well, I'll make a motion to approve with the police department's recommendation that they have a signed security plan by council.
Okay. Second.
Motion by Alder Galvin, seconded by Alder Dorff. Any discussion?
A signed security plan. Can you just brief me on that?
Sure. Back when we were having many issues with the taverns, we were getting different directions in the police department as to how to handle some of the issues with our taverns. So we came up with a universal security plan with certain requirements that they all had to meet and follow, which negated a lot of problems down the road if we did have a problem.
But it was strictly with security?
Well, it dealt basically, yes. At first it was we called it a business plan, but really we weren't concerned about how they necessarily operated their business. It was more with the security. So do they have cameras? Do they have proper lighting? Do they have enough staff? Do they have a card reader? Is the video that they would record available to us when we needed it, because we had issues with that. We had a lot of issues, like you've brought up before, about underagers going in, so the card reader became something that we thought should be mandatory because it recorded everybody coming in and the ID they used. So if there was any question later on, if someone came in with a fake ID, it would have been recorded. Things like that. So it's been standard now with all the taverns that they have a signed security plan. If they don't sign it, they can certainly go ahead and try to get the license yet, but it was something that just makes it easier for everybody down the road.
Is that a legal requirement?
You mean like a state statute?
Yeah.
No, it's, the city requires it.
We've been doing it for a while.
I know they've had these business plans, but I've always, and they may have, you know, modernized it more, but I just remember that it was, some of it got into, you know, telling them how they, what prices they couldn't have, and all this kind of thing. And I thought, I didn't think we could go that far.
There were some.
If they want to have a place that, all you can drink for $10 or something, while we frown on those things. You can't tell them how to do their business, but if they get in trouble.
There were things in there about having intoxicated servers, people that were, you know, that were determined.
Is that still in it?
Yes.
Is that lawful? That, in other words, a bartender cannot take a drink?
No, intoxicated.
Intoxicated.
Right. There were things in there about.
Okay, that makes a difference.
Music, yeah, absolutely. There were things, it got finessed over time as we found, you know, as you run into problems or issues or things that would, like you said, would infringe on their ability to run their business. It's been massaged and cleaned up quite a bit.
Okay, those are the questions I have.
Sure.
Would you like a copy? We were given copies a year or so ago.
I love paper. Sure.
Yeah, if it'd be possible to get copies of the. Okay, who, I have one, do you, anybody else care for one?
No, I would like one to read it again, because it sounds like they cleared up some of the things.
Well, it's in his packet too.
It's in the packet?
Well, in your packet here, there would be one.
Well, if it's filled out.
For this particular one.
One, yeah.
Right, but I mean.
But they're all the same.
Right.
I'm just saying our ordinance on it, you know, whatever it is.
I don't know.
I don't know if we have an ordinance.
Yeah, I don't know, I don't think we have an ordinance.
I believe it's part of just the application form.
Yeah.
Under the ordinance, they have to fill out the application form that's prescribed by the clerk, and the security plan is part of the application.
It's like a blank one that doesn't just stick in my mailbox.
Sure.
But it sounds like you cleaned up some of the questions I had, but it sounds more proper now.
Any other discussion?
I can certainly give you a blank one, but there is one in item 9 to look at as well, so.
We'll look at it.
All right. All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, that motion carries. Now, on to consideration with possible action on an application for a Class A combination license by Quick Trip Inc. at 515 West Walnut Street. Staff.
City Attorney's Office has no objection.
I concur.
We got one here.
Yep.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to comment, you know, when the Quick Trip was looking to take over what amounted to a liquor store there and a gas station, the neighborhood was basically positively in favor of it, and at least we were led to believe at the time that it was just going to have a beer license. And that, we saw that as an improvement, because that was, we felt that place had been a kind of the main offender of all the little bottles finding their way all through the neighborhoods, and, you know, people drunk on bicycles and etc. And we were kind of enthusiastic about it, because we were told it was just going to be a beer license there, and we didn't think we were going to have to deal with liquor problems. And as you know, in this is right smack dab in the middle of the neighborhoods where the three that were denied because they were in neighborhoods take place. So I don't know if it's too strong to say I felt deceived about this, but at least that was the impression that was brought to us, and we were enthusiastic about Quick Trip because of that aspect of it. And that wasn't the only thing. We loved the fact that they were going to clean up the area, put a proper fence, they're taking down the, you know, making the lot bigger and more accessible. And I think we did all we could to cooperate with it, although they seemed to take offense to a little bit of it for a while. I don't know why, but the neighborhood was looking forward to it taking over what we felt. I don't want to label it as a bad operation, because I thought the owner was a legitimate person, but the liquor store in the neighborhood. We got rid of a liquor store at the corner of 9th and Gross some years back. You know, it was more than a decade ago. And you know, they had the rights, they ended up selling it, and I think the, one of the Indian tribes owns that property, and it's not the neighborhood liquor store anymore. It's a community center, and people have been very happy about that. So I know people have different opinions. I for one, don't think we need to sell hard liquor at every corner grocery and every convenience store, as well as every grocery store and licensed liquor stores. And this one is especially kind of grievance to me because it's in the middle of the neighborhood, and there's houses all the way around it. There is one business across the street, but we were enthusiastic because we thought it was only going to be a beer license. So I don't know if we can amend this.
We can't. We can't. I was hoping we could.
You've
we
asked about it?
Sure. Yes. So we'd have to deny it, and they'd have to reapply. I don't know if we, I think we can reimburse them for this application, so they're not, you know.
We can amend it to a.
We can't.
Unless,
I'm not interested.
Unless the applicants are agreeable to amending.
Oh.
The committee wouldn't be able to unilaterally amend it, but if the applicants are willing to amend it.
Bring it back at another time. Of course, it's not due to open till what, January?
Correct. I don't think there's a timing issue, but.
And I guess I'd ask that we hold this. I'm not against hearing from people if they're here tonight, but I want to hold this until our staff could contact them and told them of our concerns, because there was that was a distinct impression. The people were very much in favor of a quick beer coming there, was that we weren't going to have liquor sales.
Is there anybody here for this item?
Move to open the floor.
Motion to open the floor.
Sure.
Second, motion by Alder Dorff to open the floor. Second by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Floor is open. You could just state your name and address, please.
Miranda O'Keefe, 2988 Sunshine Place. And I'm the agent for that quick trip. If there's any questions, I will answer questions.
Well, I was under the impression that it was also just going to be a beer license. Is something, did something?
I can't answer.
Okay.
What was applied for before, I don't know. But I do know that it is being built into it, a liquor area. But it's right off. I don't have the blueprints. I can do an awesome sketch for you. But the liquor room is right off where the registers are. And there is a door that we can open and close at 9 o'clock or when we stop selling or start selling liquor. But it's right by the registers. So they have to go right by us to get out the door. It's not separate or away.
Well, we weren't so worried about that. We were worried about the fact that it was going to be liquor sales.
Well, and that I agree with, but I personally wanted the store. I personally knew the struggles that the store would have. But all I can say is you have the reputation of Quick Trip to maybe help you kind of accept that we check IDs. We don't sell to, you know, intoxicated people. We have our own reputation to deal with. This is just what we do. We want to make it better for the neighborhood, but this license was already here beforehand, and it's something that just I don't think necessarily hurts it if it was already there. But we have the Quick Trip name and our expectations to make it better than what it was before.
Well, I think everyone agrees that that would be true.
Yeah. I mean, so it's not going to have the same reputation or expectations that it was several months ago.
Do you think you'd be amendable to just the beer?
I doubt it. I have no idea. That's not
right. Your call.
But yeah.
I was just giving your opinion.
I doubt it. I mean, it's already done, but we want to do what's best for the community and best for us at the same time. Because it's already, like I said, kind of put in place in the blueprints. So.
Questions?
not for this individual.
Yep.
Not for her.
Yeah.
A little after.
Anything else you care to add?
Nope.
Okay, thank you.
Motion. Oh, wait, no, there's other side.
Oh,
yeah. I guess one thing, is she amenable to passing the beer license and then reapplying for the liquor license portion of it?
What was the question?
So that we can discuss it every time. We don't want to hold up.
Is that you apply for the beer and possibly the liquor license, the,
Separately?
Separately.
Can we do that?
In other words, we're prepared.
Sure.
At least I.
You can sell a beer license and then they run the liquor.
Then add the liquor.
I mean, for the beer, yeah. That would be again, what would be involved with that though?
You'd have to apply.
We would amend this with your permission to, strictly the beer license and ask you to reapply for the, and we could waive the fee.
Would that, so.
So we have a separate discussion at another time about the liquor.
How long would that take though, I guess, to?
Well, till our next meeting. And you probably wouldn't be selling liquor till February or something like that.
Aren't we waiting to have that study done?
We'll mention that in a minute, yeah.
I mean, this is, I'll save it for discussion, but I guess for your understanding is that we limited the liquor licenses of three convenience stores in the general area. And some were surrounded by neighborhoods, some were a little more business oriented, but they were close to neighborhoods. And the council saw fit, and the mayor even broke a tie on one of them to limit the liquor sales in these inner city convenience stores. And this one is, fits that definition greater than all of them that we rejected so far. And like I said, I was under the impression that this was just gonna be beer, and that was one of the reasons we were enthusiastic about Welcoming Quick Trick Inn, because we thought we were getting rid of the hard alcohol aspect of it and the purchase of small bottles, and then we had some other item on our agenda here tonight, but and the nuisance that people who buy small amounts at a time and get drunk in the neighborhood and fall down on their bicycles in the alleys and stuff like that.
Is it something, is it just, and it's just the, have you gotten like any kind of blueprints or any kind of idea of what we would be selling at all?
Well,
or
I
just
think
the
all
fact
of us
that
have
just
been
the license?
Quick
okay.
I mean, I'm not trying to destroy your business
right.
plan or anything like that. It's just that that was, I mean, it's kind of hard to say others that are less egregious in location
is
shouldn't have them when one right smack dab in the middle of the neighborhood, which was the original complaint that brought forward an item that's a little later on our agenda regarding the single serve cells and stuff like that. And I mean, there's nobody casting anything negative about Quick Trip and how they operate and how dedicated they are to what they try to do, but that this is would be a sore point with me. I know I couldn't support that. If it had to be together, then I wouldn't support anything.
So if we reapply with two, would that be on the 20th that we'd have to go over this, or would this be at a later date?
You could get the one with the beer right away here, and that would be in place. There'd be some time here in the next month or two before we'd have a chance to discuss the liquor portion of it.
Okay.
And I guess I'd want the neighborhood people to be able to be aware of it and that sort of thing. So
basically, it's all it's two separate ones or nothing.
Well, okay. With me, I can't speak for anybody else.
Question?
Yes, it is. Because I was under the same impression as Alder Zima that there was not going to be hard liquor sold here, and I heard that over and over again. So my question is, had you heard that? Is this like brand new? That
it,
this is the first time you've heard
that? Yeah, as far as I know, it was going to be both.
Wow. Okay.
So, but I don't know. I mean, this has been in the plans. Like when I looked at the blueprints, this has been in the plans for several months as to taking over that corner and stuff. So I don't know when that.
Well,
they're even doing a better job there than we thought they were going to do. So I mean, the neighbors and myself are pleased with it. We were asked about red brick and all that sort of thing. We like that idea. And then they were going to do it two colors because they're going to save part. But they did redo the whole thing with the red brick. And we're not unhappy with the design or anything like that.
Okay.
But it was that was a big part of us supporting it at that time. You're happy to get rid of the liquor store.
Yeah. By my ask, the plans were okayed by the planning department, correct? That all went through?
I'm assuming so.
Because, yeah, I...
Well, how would the planning department know that?
They would know what we did.
They had agreed not to sell hard liquor.
Yeah.
Well, if there's a spot, huh?
That's something you'll find out, or I found out with the city. One hand doesn't always know what the other hand is doing.
Get out.
Yeah, believe it or not.
Okay, anyway, enough discussion amongst ourselves. Any more questions for... Okay. But we never did finish. Would you consider changing this to a class?
It actually, reviewing the application, it looks like they were asking for a Class A beer, a Class A liquor, and cigarette permits. And the way that it is structured in our ordinances, a Class A is one for beer only, for off-premise consumption is one license, and a Class A liquor is another license. So they're two separate licenses. The combo license for liquor and beer is for on-site.
So we could approve two of them and hold the other one.
Or approve one and hold the other, correct?
Well, there's three of them. There's a cigarette license there too, or something.
So,
right,
we
didn't
apply for a combo.
Right.
Two separate.
They're two separate ones.
So they're
yes.
already separate the way that they're.
Correct.
Asking.
Yes, that's what it looks like. The combo, the Class B combo for liquor and beer, is for on-site consumption. While this is for off-premise, so the Class A beer authorizes retail sales of fermented malt beverages in original packages, containers, and bottles for consumption off the premises where sold. And then Class A liquor license is the same, sale of intoxicating liquor in original packages, containers, and bottles for consumption off the premises where sold. So they're two separate licenses, it's not a combo. So you could approve one and hold the other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, move to return to regular order business.
Motion to return to regular second. Order by Alder Zima, seconded by Alder Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We're up here.
I'd make that motion to approve the beer license and to hold the other license for future discussion and decision.
Second.
Okay, motion by Alder Zima, seconded by Alder Dorf. Any discussion?
Just a couple things. Mm-hmm. If staff could find some kind of written documentation. Because I'll be honest, I do not remember Quick Trip promising not to sell anything but beer. But if they did, they certainly should stand by that.
I don't think they promised.
But if staff has anything, well, and this is part of, if there's any kind of anything in writing, or minutes from meetings or anything mm-hmm. that shows that they agreed not to sell liquor, I'd be interested in seeing that. And then I guess if we're going to hold it, I would hold it until we're done with ours.
I don't think it was specifically stated that way. What was talked about is that it was only going to be beer sales. We didn't talk about that they were not going to sell hard liquor anymore. It wasn't brought up that way. Okay. But.
Right.
All right. Well, then, I don't know how we can.
Well, I think we can do just what the motion says, and it'll be on in our next agenda, that's all.
But if it's on the next agenda and we don't have our study done yet.
Oh, I'm not against looking for what you're asking for. I think that's fine.
Yeah, I mean, if we were to hold it until, are we going to hold all of these applications until the study's done? Or are we going to do it on a case by case?
Well, I think they're all case by case.
You know, and again, this is part of the problem I'm having going forward is, what's the criteria for case by case? Is it population density, the amount of residential versus commercial property? Is it calls for service for the fire department or the police department? Is it we get the neighbors together and they come in and let us know they don't want it? Or
all of the above.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying, just to be fair to everybody going forward, and first also, I guess, with the study, we'd get some answers about whether restricting hard liquor versus beer is going to have any impact on a neighborhood or a community. So I guess I would, for discussion, so we're not making them come back in or have other people coming in back and forth. If we could get around to establish something or just restrict everything for the time being until we do come up with some parameters.
Mr. Governor, are you under the impression that this committee can't make decisions regarding these licenses and what we want of them? I mean, we really don't need to exist here to approve licenses. It's just a matter of passing a a character check by the police department.
And I understand.
In other words, we have a right to say what we want in certain areas and not other areas. We make all kinds of decisions like that all the time in zoning, you know, plan commission. They give exceptions to this and not to this, and et cetera, and on it goes. That's part of our job here. Now, you may be of the opinion that you think it should be all or nothing, and I respect that,
well,
if that's what it is, but I don't think it's that way.
But I think, well, and I agree with you. I don't think it's black or white, but I think if we had some guidelines with which to work with, because sometimes it just seems kind of, we have a gut feeling that this is a bad thing, so we deny, and we have a gut feeling it's a good thing, and we approve, and I don't know if that's necessarily the right way to go about doing it.
Well, that is part of it. You look at the character, people coming forward, their believability, everything else. You know, we have people with some kids commit some serious crimes, and sometimes we deny them, and sometimes we give them a second chance. It's based on, you know, intuition has part of it. But, you know, we've denied three others in that general area. And, you know, of course, I don't think it's very fair to say that one in that area can do it and the rest can't. Mm-hmm. Because then, well, that should hurt the other people's business. It should be equal. But I think this is right in the center of the neighborhood. That's why I'd like it held up for a separate discussion, but I don't want to stop them from their
sure.
beer license right now.
Yes?
So what I was looking at was that it definitely, as we went along, had heard stated out loud, and I'm not sure by whom, but that there was not going to be liquor at the Quick Trip. Maybe the Quick Trip never said it out loud, but it was certainly part of the discussion. And if they were in the room when it was going on, they didn't correct that impression. But I absolutely remember all those women talking about it. I remember us discussing it here. And so that is what is impacting my decision on this particular
item. Well, if it got going by hearsay or something, well, it's hearsay that I heard. And that was one of the things that made me enthusiastic about this herb.
Sure. And I understand, yeah. You know, what you're saying. I mean, so many times we've seen in the past where people go ahead and start doing stuff and investing money, and they haven't even gotten permission from the city yet to go ahead with it. And then we get that, well, they've already invested this much money. We might as well just go ahead and give it to them. And again, the city ends up taking the short end of the stick on that. And so, yeah, I agree with you.
Sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
Well, my two cents are that we are in the middle of deciding whether we want to do a liquor moratorium for convenience stores. We're still figuring that out, which would not only affect Quick Trip, but every store in the city. And we certainly have, the council has, I did not agree with it, but the council has passed that the inner city is not a place where we want convenience stores to sell hard liquor. And I would certainly want, though I question that, I would certainly want that to be true for everyone within that area if that's what we're going to do. So I want to make the playing field as level as possible for all concerned. So
I agree with you. I think if we're having a criteria for a certain area, then we stick to that in that area.
In that area, yeah.
You don't say one yes to one and no to the other one. You might have difference between one area and another area, and you know whatever the criteria we might set, but you know it's all subject to our decision-making process.
Right. So if when we come back to that discussion about our moratorium, I'm hoping that either all can sell hard liquor or all will just sell beer, is what I anticipate supporting, one or the other. So for now, I support definitely going forward with the beer license. Everybody else in the convenience store is selling that, and no one else has been allowed to sell hard liquor, so I want to hold that until we can decide what we're going to do with that. So that was the motion, and it was seconded? The motion was made? Okay.
Motion made by Alderman Zima, seconded by Alderman Dorf.
Okay, all in favor?
The beer.
To approve the Class A beer only and hold the Class A liquor. To the next P&W meeting.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, so I don't think that'll change at council, but you never know. But that's how it is going forward. Thank you. 9. Consideration with possible action on an application for an available Class B combination license by CH Bar LLC at 301 South Broadway, formerly the Crunchy Frog. This item has previously discussed at the November 14th B&W meeting and placed on hold for further review. I remember this, yes.
Yes, we're waiting for the owner.
For the owner. Is the owner here?
The owner is here. I'm also appearing for him.
Oh, okay. Super.
Motion open the floor.
So. Yeah. Motion open the floor by Alder
second.
Galvin, second by Alder Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Good evening. I am Attorney David Dahl. I'm here on behalf of CH Bar LLC. The applicant has asked me to look into the issue. Apparently what happened last time was got stalled because of the history of Mr. Hernandez's ownership of Club 720 Cocos in La Cuerva. There were some questions about the previous owners or the previous history of citations. I did go and I looked at the court records, and it appears to me that to the extent that history is the principal concern here, that there were five convictions over the course of 10 years. Three of them are very minor, sale to underage, two underage loitering. The convictions occurred over an extended period of time. It's been over 3 years since the last citation. Mr. Hernandez has no criminal record other than some moving violations. The clientele for the contemplated bar is a significant change from the previous occupant, which was Crunchy Frog, which is death metal. This one is 35 and up, is the target market. To address an additional issue that Mr. Calhoun indicated may, or Mr. Hernandez indicated may be a question as to whether or not Mr. Andrew Calhoun would be associated with this enterprise. Mr. Calhoun ran the Liquid 8 and there were some problems over there. The answer is Mr. Calhoun has no ownership in the corporation that's going to operate the building. The bar has no ownership in the building. To the extent that it pleases the committee also, we would be willing to change the stipulation to indicate that Mr. Calhoun would not have a role as an employee either. And hopefully that sufficiently addresses that. There was one additional issue that apparently was a holdup on the stipulation. One of the line items, Mr. Hernandez agreed to consent to everything. There was one where he refused. It was simply a matter of the language. I think it mattered that the owner or the proprietor of the institution, the establishment, would not have any alcoholic beverages during his presence on the premises. He's got no problems with agreeing not to be intoxicated, but it is a little bit difficult for a bar owner not to have the occasional drink if somebody wants to buy a round. It's just the custom to do so. So overall, and I do have the history of, to the extent that the committee wants to see, the history of charges for that premises, I've got it. Earlier today, the Green Bay Police Department records office did give me a copy of the citation. So to the extent that you would like, I can pass it on to counsel or answer questions on any of those citations.
Take a copy.
Does the PD have a copy?
What would you like?
I have a couple of statistics that you were requesting.
Okay. We have some data, too, from the police department.
I'll just let you pass around,
sure. Okay? Why wanted that one?
I can switch. Questions?
You said that these violations were minor. The loitering by a juvenile in a tavern was a minor issue.
One of them was his brother that showed up on site to help him clean up. So yeah, I do think that that's pretty minor. It's not an acceptable activity to have a minor on the location, but also you have to dig a little bit deeper into some of the facts of some of these offenses.
Which one was that?
From what I understand, and I only got the records, sir, today afternoon, the 2006 incident with underage sale or underage presence loitering, that was his brother. That was 10/12/2006. That's when the actual conviction was entered. The citation was a little bit earlier than that.
Okay, so on 10/12, there was allowing underage to loiter. That was dismissed. Sale of alcohol underage person, that was dismissed. Was that part of a plea agreement?
That's the interesting thing, is it's what I asked for Mr. Hernandez. I also asked the clerk at the municipal court if they kept any kind of transcript or recording of what was agreed to, because typically a dismissed without prejudice implies that you've got to obey some terms or conditions. In every case, Mr. Hernandez went down there and indicated that he didn't think the charge was supported. There was no agreement. The district or the city council simply dismissed him without prejudice.
City council dismissed him? Can we do that?
Or agreed to dismiss without prejudice.
Well, I don't think city council can agree to dismiss.
I don't know if that was a municipal citation or not.
It would have been municipal citations.
Yeah, then that would have been city prosecutor agreeing to that if it was
city
a
council
citation.
SEL, not CIL. Sorry.
Right.
Oh, okay. I'm
the
sorry.
The city prosecutor, like, yes.
Wow. All right.
Yeah, it's a little different.
So I guess my understanding would be that in 06 there were probably more than one person other than his brother that was in the establishment that was underage, and that's why there was a conviction and a dismissal on some of the other charges. 05, allowing underage to loiter and tavern open after hours, those were dismissed. Disorderly house, I believe he's got three convictions for those.
I have two.
I've got.
One was dismissed.
Yeah.
2010 was dismissed. My understanding that pretty much all these dismissals were all part of plea agreements.
That's not the case. It's not the case, and I'll let Mr. Hernandez speak for himself, as it was, you know, and unfortunately there's no recording. Obviously there's not a court transcriptionist there. He just shows up. Vincente says this isn't supported, dismisses him, pays the fine, and takes the guilty on several of the other ones. So I wish that there was more that I could offer you on that, but you know, when you consider whether or not it's prudent to give him the license, I think that the important thing is to understand that it's really the ones that he was found guilty of that make a difference. And obviously there are background facts that you need to consider, but here what we've got is we've got five convictions over the course of 10 years. Makes a difference between a dismissed charge and a prosecuted charge.
I don't have any other questions. I have a discussion, but you'd be amenable to reopening the floor.
Absolutely.
So, did you understand?
Oh, I would just like to say, too, that I mean, I have the verbal judo from the police. I have the certificate from them. So, I mean, I've been taking care of all the situations. I got the certification from the CERV, from here to OC. I've been working on everything for the past 10 years to keep everything good and clean and good. So, which I think I've been doing a really good job for that. That's just what I want to say.
Return to regular order business.
Second.
Most by Alexander, return to regular order. Second by Alderdorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We are now back amongst ourselves. Any discussion or motion?
Can we take a look at what the police department has for us?
Oh, certainly. Good idea.
Well, I think we, at our last meeting, and I'm not against revisiting it, but at our last meeting, I thought we had sort of decided that there were quite a few problems at his previous place until 3 years ago. And the type of clientele maybe added to it and all that, but it's his responsibility anyway. But since then, he's had a clean record, and you know, I know my feeling is if we've issued a license to him and he's a member in good standing of the community for the last 3 years, why would it be any different today? So I mean, I didn't like some of the things I heard before, but if we've reissued him licenses for three consecutive years and we have not had problems, why would we not think he would run a decent shop and give him a chance to do it?
Is there anything?
Yeah, at Alderman Galvin's request at the November 14th meeting, he asked for copies of violations that we had come across. Once you get your packets, you'll note that there's two names in our record management system. It's the same person, but because it's a hyphenated name, we have two different locations where he was found in our system. And I've highlighted various infractions that Mr. Hernandez had been involved in with his tavern over the course of the past 10 years. Now, these are the citations that are issued at the police department level. What happens after it is kind of out of our hands from that point on.
So these are the calls for service at that establishment?
And also further back, if you get a little bit out of that packet, attached to that packet is the calls for service that we've had at the two locations at 718 Bodart and 720 Bodart. And you'll see, obviously, several of them have occurred at that location.
How many total calls does this have on here?
If you look at the last page, I hope it says. At the very last page, it'll have a total.
346.
So for 718, there's 346 calls that took place from April of 2006 through early December of 16, so 10 years. And then at the 720 Bodart, from that same time period, there were 132 calls for service. So we're close to 500 calls for service at those two businesses in the past 10 years.
In the last
10 years?
Last 2 years or 3 years. I mean, when you look at some of these, maybe you could help me, officer, but you know, some say suspicious person, some say, you know, a hang-up. These are things that, these aren't all things that occurred within this bar. So if somebody was stopped for speeding right in front of that place, or walking down the street and was causing a commotion with someone, they would still show up at that address. These are by address, aren't they?
In an ideal world, if it was not associated with the address, the officer would have called out with 100 block of that area. However, if it is associated with that particular address, then the officer would use the address as the call location. Can't say that happens all the time, but that would be what happens in an ideal world.
Well, something here, it says, I'm just looking at one that says theft. You know, all it says is theft. Well, is that inside the bar, or?
I could only say that that's what happened. And again, if the officer used that address to where the theft occurred, then that's how it is recorded in the record.
Somebody might have stole something out of a car in a parking lot there or something, or on the street, or?
If it's associated with that tavern, or yes, that's probably what would happen.
I know we've sort of had trouble with this in the past. You know, I just remember the committee that you can't ask for all the details of every single thing. And I know sometimes they put the address of whatever is happening, and they put the address of the closest building or whatever it is. But I don't know if you can go by these things or not.
I don't know a lot about comparison, so how does this compare to other bars in the area, the number of calls here?
I can only speak from personal experience, being a former night shift employee. During that time, this was one of our high call volume businesses. And I want to note that each one of these calls aren't just simple calls. They're oftentimes multiple officer calls that are responding and using up the police department resources to solve that situation. So.
And so, this Coco's was closed. Is it closed?
I believe it's changed names. Same ownership, but changed names over the years.
That's why there's still such a recent. There was one in 12/2/16 in this little packet. So there's something still existing in that spot. So this is kind of a lot. I mean, it seems like a lot here.
Yes.
I guess that's the point I wanted to have made here. In my experience on the department, we had establishments that we would go to maybe never within a year's time, or very few. And we have over 500 calls for service. I'm not saying they're all directly a result of his management skills or style, but you're looking at over 150 reports were issued, which means officers are putting pen to paper, documenting incidents that took place that were serious enough that a report had to be made. Many times on a weekend night, it would be too busy for officers to necessarily take action. They would just have to keep it in mind for the next go-around. But when you look at 500 calls for service, you figure the amount of officers on the road are 12 to 16, depending upon the time of night. You're sending 2-4, sometimes the entire department, to an establishment because of the way it's being operated. It's a huge strain on city services. I know they pay taxes, but I don't think their taxes come close to covering the cost of that kind of security that needs to be rendered at that establishment. I've watched the city struggle for years with establishments such as these. For one reason or another, we've had issues trying to hold them accountable and make them responsible for the businesses that they run. And I've seen it, I felt sorely lacking, and it continued to drain the police and fire department resources, hospital resources, mental health resources. And this is the main reason I wanted to make everyone vividly aware of what has happened at this place in the past. I would also point out that he could say he's going to have an establishment that he wants to have people over 35. He's going to have soft, soothing music. He's going to have a piano bar, ballroom dancing. And when he opens the door, he doesn't have to have that. There's nothing that we can do to hold him to that. And, you know, we just have to trust that that's what's going to happen. And if we go down the rabbit hole and we end up with another problem establishment, my experience has been it's very difficult, again, to hold these places accountable and to have them reined in so that we can have the police where they belong, which is all over the city and everyone's neighborhoods, protecting everybody. And that's why it may be 3 years since he's had his last citation, but I have a lot of concern about this application.
Can we ask the certificates to be brought up here? I want to see what years he did those programs.
The certificates? I will say that a few years back we did have a semi-judicial hearing on his establishment. There was an incident that was quite a drain on our on resources, and it we did not deny him his license at that time, because at that time we felt there were a number of establishments, especially downtown, whose records were just as bad, if not worse, and that we felt there was part of the escalation of that one incident was due to miscommunication. That was certainly, he was responsible for that, but we were sympathetic to the Hispanic culture and the miscommunication to the police, and we had hoped that going forward that would be worked on, and the establishment would not be a problem establishment anymore. And since that time, that has been the case. So I credit the police and I credit the owner for working together and making a situation that was full of misunderstanding and problems into a good business situation. So I can offer that detail for your consideration.
Well, I think if you look at the calls just for this year alone, there's 19 calls for service. I'm not sure how that would compare with all the other establishments in Green Bay, but it'd be interesting to see. We have 5, 6, 7. We have 8 of those calls resulted in reports. disturbances, suspicious persons, disturbances, ordinance violation, disturbances. I guess I'm just not convinced. I think based on what I've seen other municipalities, how they've handled their liquor licenses and what they've done with them, I think that the city can do better. And I think we do that by establishing that we're not going to tolerate the improper operation of liquor establishments. And I just, he may not have gotten a citation in the last few years, but I don't know if that necessarily means it's okay to allow him to have another establishment open up.
Yes?
I guess I was curious about the dates on these, because I wanted to see how recent, you know, on the Surf Safe certification, which I'm not really sure, that's food protection. And the other one is a food one. But the verbal judo was back in 07. And in 07 and 08 and 09, there were lots of violations. So I was just trying to see, wow, did what he learned have an impact on his ability to manage? And it didn't, from the evidence I see. It didn't, but it was in 07, which is 9 years ago. So that was my purpose for asking for these. Thank you for providing them.
Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I just took the liberty, these all kind of come in here hodgepodge a little bit, but they're in general order. But I counted up the total calls, or at least records.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think they're all calls for service there, but I counted up a total of 50. There's been since January 1st of 2014, roughly 3 years ago. There's been 50. And some of them are suspicious persons, suspicious vehicle, traffic stop, theft, accident. You know, there's everything and everything in here. They aren't all calls for disturbances at the bar. And I think the fact that you don't have any citations given during that period, it means that there wasn't anything inappropriate on the part of the owner in doing this. Now, I tell you, Stirrups downtown is owned by the county executive. I can guarantee you that that address has got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of stops on it. And I'm not saying that the owner of the bar did anything there, but there aren't any violations there, but there are still calls for services in that general area. And you just, I think you've got to look at the record. In other words, was there anything serious enough that our officers who dealt with this in the past, and you had a quasi-judicial hearing and everything else on top of it, and I don't think the department curried any favor to a person who had such problems with Coco's and over there in that area, what used to be Speeds and that. There haven't been any citations since then.
You're aging yourself now. Speeds.
Yeah, well,
sorry, well, I couldn't help.
Well, I stopped drinking, unlike yourself, Bob,
yeah,
30 years ago. So, no, I'm just kidding. But anyway, I just look at it. I mean, either he's in good standing or isn't in good standing. Is the department saying they think we should not give this license?
That would be the department's recommendation.
And what would you base that on?
Based on the past history of the number of calls that we've had at his establishments.
But he hasn't had any citations in over 3 years. So he must have improved his operation, because he was in nothing but problems there before. I mean, the problems are pretty heavy. You look back at 7 and 8 and 9. I'm only operating a little bit through hearsay from people, too. I guess it was the clientele and the type of music and everything that was being promoted, and that it wasn't well handled. But if did you recommend that we not give him his license the last 3 years where he is right now, the department?
I wasn't part of
did
that.
Did the committee override time. It or anything?
I'm not aware of any recommendation to deny his license at the current establishment.
Do they have the ability to? We don't have the ability to deny.
Sure, we do. Every year, as he applies, if there's violations, we can take that into account and not apply, give him his license, if I'm understanding it correctly.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there would be a hearing before P&W, and they wouldn't have to ultimately go to council, but there's specific violations that would have to occur in order for revocation, suspension, or non-renewal.
In the past,
so it's a little bit more limited.
I think it was a good policy. In the past, going back before you're being on the council or our attorneys were even here, but in the month or so before our liquor license were going to be renewed, we asked the department, at least the committees I sat on, to bring us problem properties. Anything that they considered problem property. And there was usually a list of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 even, that they were having, you know, more calls to it than they felt were that they should have. And we brought them forward one at a time and, you know, put them on the hot seat, and we'd let them know that, you know, things had improved, they were going to continue to get their liquor license, and it was fairly effective. But I think if we don't do that anymore, this is again my first year here, but back, but I think that's what we should be doing. And people that stay in good standing, you know, I think you have to give them the opportunity to have their business. Now, if they're not in good standing, then we should. And those weren't situations where we were giving a quasi-judicial hearing.
Mm-hmm.
We were bringing up these problem properties that we've had more problems than we feel we should have with them. And we're getting on top of it right away, and I think that worked pretty well. We saw reductions in the problems they had after that. And in the rare occasions, we'd have a quasi-judicial hearing. But I think at this point here, I mean, you look down, I don't know that the calls are excessive. There isn't one that resulted in a citation to the bar, unless I'm misunderstanding anything here. Like, if it says disturbance, what can that mean? A couple people arguing on the street that may not have even been in that bar?
Well, like I said, in that perfect world, if that argument involved people that came from that establishment, then that address would have been used in the computer-aided dispatch. If it was not involved, then the officer, in a perfect world, would have used the 100 block or the intersection of where that occurred.
Well, then why wouldn't they do that with an accident, for instance? There's a lot of things in here: accident, suspicious person, traffic stop. They're using a specific address.
Well, it could have happened in the parking lot. I don't have that information of things like that, but it could have happened in the parking lot of the business.
If there's a report number associated with, say, a disturbance, the last one, page 11, that would indicate there might have been an arrest made.
It's at least a
report. It was significant enough that a report had to be done. And
we're not certain that it involved the tavern.
It would have involved people within that tavern. And again, that's what I'm pointing to, is that just because they don't get a ticket because there's been a documented violation, if they run an establishment where the police are continuously going there, spending their time there, if we had a home like that with 20 calls for service in a neighborhood, the neighbors would be up in arms. We would have the community police interacting with the owners of the home or the landlord. Here we have a establishment with 500 calls, and maybe not all of them are directly related to them, but 500 calls for service over a 10-year period. And you look at some of the other establishments, Vicente's, Liquid 8, those are the people that you would compare to an establishment like this. And we know what kind of problems they also cause us, and the media attention that was focused on them because of those problems. We look at the damage to the city, and maybe people don't see that, but when you only have 12 officers on the road and they're spending 20 times at this establishment over a period of a year, and I think if you were to look at the other, because I remember getting the data on all the taverns by address, and 20 would be a lot for many of them. And so this is why, and my big issue here also is, once it's out for at least a year. and then we have to start all over again, establishing the protocols to deal with it once it becomes a problem. And I'm just, you know, we got burned on Vincenzi's, we got burned on Liquid 8, we've been burned on a number of them. I know you bring up the Country Western Bar, and we've had a lot of calls there. I'm not sure what their status is right now or how things have been there, but I'm just, this is my main concern. Also, this is
they never get a ticket.
Well, I don't know about that.
Surprise, surprise.
This is also a moratorium area. And, you know, it sits in a moratorium area that at one point this council decided that there were enough taverns in this area that it impacted the neighborhoods and the quality of life, and that they wanted to restrict how many were there. And that's something else I think we need to take into consideration. You know, like you said before, we're trying to change the image of this city, and I have a concern about that.
Well, this isn't the adding of a license, is it?
It's been empty for a year, the establishment. So there's been no liquor business there for a year. Yeah, he's attempting to open a new business. Doesn't matter if there used to be one there or not. It went away, and it's in a moratorium area, and now he's trying to reopen another one there.
So is there to reopen it now? Does it take a certain percentage of the council to do that?
I believe it does, and I'm not sure what the number is, if it's 8 or 9.
Two-thirds. Or
something like that, yeah.
Are you aware of that?
I'm not aware of that, no.
I thought it was 3/4.
Has it been vacant for over a year?
That's what I was told, yes.
Is that correct?
I would say yes.
Well, then it might take an extraordinary vote. So, well, I get two minds about these things. And the Country Fork, that's right near the bridge, isn't it?
Do you know where the school board is?
Yeah.
Walk across the street and then down a block south.
I know what you mean. Yeah. Well, like I say, I have two minds about it.
So which mind are you going to go with?
I see arguments on both sides of it. People have kept the record clean and they want to do a new establishment. I mean, I suppose you could put some stipulation on it. Is the building being leased now? Is that the idea? Or?
I think it's empty.
I don't know. I don't know what the status of the building is.
Did we find that out? Or?
I know what it is, if you want
to. Motion to open the floor.
Second. Motion by Alder Mallon to open the floor. Second by Alder Dorff. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
I guess you've heard the discussion here, and anything you want to address.
Certainly.
I think this is a time to do it.
Sure.
The ownership, I guess we're looking at the ownership of the building.
Certainly.
Do we need his name and address again, or since he's already entered?
Just state your name.
Attorney David Dahl for the applicant. Addressing first the lease issue, the property was sold on a land contract to this entity. To a separate entity, VAG LAC. There is a lease between VAG and the applicant entity. Okay.
Is that lease subject to getting a license?
The lease, they signed it. They signed it, so I don't think it's subject to anything. Mr. Hernandez did it himself. He's not giving me a copy of it. But we talked about that before the meeting. My suspicion is that it's not subject to getting a license.
That isn't too smart either.
Well, sir, I think the general transcourse there was he did the simplest thing that he could do, got the form from someone else. Before we came over here, we discussed that issue, and assuming the application is approved, we're going to take another look at the lease and get that straightened out.
We understand what Mr. Galvin said earlier, that, you know, people go and spend a lot of money, and then they think, well, just because we spent it, we need to feel obligated to give them a chance. And, of course, that is always, boy, doing things after the fact is never sets well with me, I know, but as you heard from some of my discussion, I feel if the person's kept their nose clean, I wanted to give them a chance.
And we appreciate that. And to the extent that the committee does want to consider the personal investment in this matter, substantially the assets that he does have in addition to some assets borrowed from his father to obtain title to the property. So he's made a huge personal investment in this.
Oh, he owns it now, or is he leasing?
The property was purchased on a land contract.
By
a corporation that he set up.
Okay.
The purchaser was the corporation. Okay.
So he's leasing it from his own corporation?
That's right, and that's why it is.
For tax purposes or something?
I'm not entirely sure why he did. That's what he did. People often purchase a piece of real estate in one name and then lease it, operate it as a business in another entity's name.
Okay, so he owns the property indirectly through a corporation?
That's right, yes.
And he's gonna pay rent to that corporation for the use of the building, so he's leasing it?
That's right.
But he technically, he and other people own the property?
He and his father purchased, he and his father are, both have an interest in the corporation that purchased the building.
So he's getting money from dad, and that's why the dad's in the...
That's right.
A part of the corporation.
Right.
I just yield the floor to Mr. Galvin.
I have no further questions.
Any other questions?
I guess we looked at the squad calls there.
Right.
In the last 3 years, I had counted that there'd been 50, a total of 50. It's around 17 a year or something like that. But I also noted in there that there were, like here, there's medical problems or whatever. Not all of them seem to have involved disturbances or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But have you looked over those?
So the data that you're looking at, I do not have.
Over it? Can he give us some evaluation of those 50 police police stops at that address?
Between the last citation being issued and today?
I just counted the ones from
right.
January 1st of 2014, roughly 3 years ago.
Certainly. Vincente, I'm going to ask you to comment on those types of citations.
Just please state your name again.
My name is Vicente Hernandez.
Did you testify before? Did we get your address?
Yeah,
I'm not sure if he stated his address. You can go ahead and state your address.
31 McCormick Street, Greenville, Wisconsin.
Yeah.
I don't know how to answer that question. I would say we need to get the...
Have you had the police inside your place for...
In the past 3 years inside? No, I mean, yes, we might have them outside for somebody who wants to walk in and we don't want them in. Or maybe... some situation, but I called
you generated them?
Pretty much all of them, it's going to be me or some of my team, that we need assistance. And some
do you want assistance from somebody trying to get in your place that you rejected?
Most of the time, just when they're not allowed, or they're not supposed to be drinking, or they're intoxicated, and they're outside just trying to get in. That's ones that I can right now remember.
You know how many times the police have been inside the establishment? Do you have any idea about that?
In the past 3 years?
Yeah.
I would say one, they came in, they say that they were looking for some Andres that somebody else called, and they didn't find anybody. That somebody trying to, that we don't let nobody in, or we don't let no Andres, and they get mad, and they call police just to go get us. That happened once in the past 3 years, yes. But they didn't find anything. And they told me, no, we got a call, so we got to check it. I'm like, more than welcome, come on in.
I guess, would you go over what transition took place within yourself between the problems you had 5 to 10 years ago and the last 3 years? What has changed in your mode of operation that you feel make you qualified to have another license?
In 2000...
And some will say if you can't handle one, you can't handle two.
When the city of Green Bay started doing the whole downtown closing 5-6 Vicencies and these type of bars, I think that started about 2010, 2011. That crowd, I used to have a jukebox on a Wednesday or Thursday at the place. That crowd started sparring out from all Green Bay. So sooner or later, I mean, I know they went to one bar in downtown, two other different bars. They got to my place too. So I'm a Latino. We play Latin bachata salsa dance every Friday and Saturday. That's what we play right now, and that's what we've been playing since 2006 until now. So the most troubles or that we got was when the environment of the hip hop and R&B crowd started getting there on the Thursday or Wednesday or Thursday, that they used to be able to play the jukebox. At the time, we didn't know how to control the jukebox that we learn now how to do it. We can cancel the songs or any of those songs that they want to have. I mean, they cannot even, if they want to play, they're not going to be able to play. So honestly, that was what had started happening. On a Wednesday or Thursday night, I was bartender myself, and maybe it was another security guy there. And then one of them showed up, and then two more. And then after we knew, we had 10 or 15 of them, 20 of them, and I didn't have the staff enough either way for that crowd that I don't want the crowd. I never wanted there, I didn't want the crowd, and I'm not in intention to do no hip hop at any place that I would open or I would do. That's what happened in that time or that area. When they closed these bars, they started just trying to find a spot, which I don't see them around up here anymore.
So you say that the transformation when you change the type of entertainment,
when I changed,
type of persons that you're leading?
When I changed the name of Cocos to what's called La Cueva, 100% Spanish or Latin, and we closed, that made that crowd just never come in. We took away the jukebox and we just handled the DJ by ourselves. So each time they asked for any of that kind of music, we didn't play it. As a matter of fact, we played more Latin or country kind of Latin so they could leave. And that was the only way we could get them off. Or to handle it the safest way to be able to control what we did now.
You're saying that's where all your problems came from?
Most of the stronger problems, yes. But no, yes. We do have some Latino guys that were trouble. I'm not going to say no, yes. What happens in 10 years, I mean, when anybody starts a business, now, it's different. This is a bar nightclub who has a dance floor. When it's a tavern, I think officers know, we all know this. When it's a tavern, it's small and better and more relaxed. When you have a dance floor, it's different. Now, when I opened up in 2006, I didn't know the patrons. I didn't know who fight it. I didn't know who drink more. You just open up and you let the customers come in. And then when time right now that we get to know more who they are, I mean, we know who the guy that used to fight or wanted to fight, he's not allowed anymore. Either his son that is old enough, we don't allow him anymore. Or you get to know the patrons who are...
You know how to avoid trouble.
Exactly. One of them is that a couple, male and female, they're together for a year, 2 years. Then they get divorced, separated, or their girlfriend, and then the male shows up with another female, and then she females show up with their friends. And that's how it starts most of the times. Females get jealous, goes tell the other girl what is she doing with his ex, and something starts. We controlled it, and everything's been really good since then. Since we understand who's who, since we understand how it works. It was a process for me to understand how the police works, to be able to get along and try to get the way that we are now. But it's pretty much, that's what I would say, it's like that. Now we understand most about the business and the patrons.
So how many calls a year do you think police ought to be at a tavern?
It's hard to put a number on that. But I would say from a tavern, a bar tavern, from a dance nightclub, I think it's kind of different in a way, but I mean, I could not make that decision. I think that would be the city to do and to work together to make it happen good and better, which I think I've improved in that in the past 3 years.
You think there was a long learning curve on your part to figure out how to operate your place without problems?
Well, it's kind of obvious.
Not a long curve. I think when I started understanding my patrons, the Latinos ones, everything was going well. So they started closing down the other ones and they started showing up. That was a different situation that we had.
But then you had to learn how to control them at the door. I mean, if you don't let the problem in, then you don't have to have the
correct
problem leave. I mean, I've heard people say hip-hop music, but let's face it. When I started on a job in 1980, there was no such thing as hip-hop music. And guess what? We had bad bars with large disturbances and high volumes of police calls. So it wasn't hip-hop music then. You know, and it wasn't rock and roll, and it wasn't country western, and it wasn't Latino music or polka music. It was the way people operated their establishments. Either they controlled what went into and what happened within their establishment, or they didn't, one or the other. Yeah. You know, and the result was police calls for service.
Correct. And sometimes when you don't know the patron, I mean, you let him in. And then after he's inside, you can see that what's going on with him. So he's not allowed to come back anymore. Am I wrong? I mean, how can I know who's wrong and who's right when they go inside our establishment? Until I get to know what he does, or until we understand who he does.
Or you can understand if he's intoxicated when he's coming through
the
door.
Of course, so you don't allow him in.
Or you don't over-serve people.
Correct.
Or you do have more staff on hand so that you can keep an eye on your patrons.
Correct, and that's what we do. The problem was on the Wednesday and Thursday, we were not catering to them. We didn't want them around, or we only used to have 4 to 5 people, normal customers. And then out of one night at 11 or 12, we had this 20, 30 crowd out of nowhere. It's like, wow, whoa, now what do we do? Or how do we? So what we did was just close down. We closed down on Wednesday. And that's the only way that we control it. And of course, taking out the jukebox. That was the other good one.
Okay.
Anyone else? Anything else?
I just wanted to point out that to the department, with all due respect, if the statistics are presented, they really should be presented in a useful way. We need comparative data for the same period for similar bars. Mr. Zima, with very brief analysis, you know, struck out many of the calls for the period since the last citation. Many of them, as to Mr. Hernandez's credit, originated with him. Now, one of the principal problems with taverns of this sort are disorderly houses, and it is incumbent upon the owner and the manager of a bar to summon law enforcement when a situation becomes something that they can't deal with. So are you getting them in a catch-22 situation where, you know, if you call and ask for help, well, we're going to hold that against you, but if you don't, we're going to give it to you with a disorderly house. So it's a situation, the way that you're framing this is not really fair to him. And when you talk about the average violations between 2013 and now, you're talking about 16 a year for a dance club. And, you know, to be honest and be candid, there is going to be a significant difference between 19-year-olds that are single and unattached and consuming alcohol in a dance club setting and a tavern such, excuse 21-year-olds, in a situation where you have
I know I look under 21.
Yeah. So, and there's just a different character. And what I think you've heard here from Mr. Hernandez is a very candid assessment and a very earnest portrayal of the trials that he's gone through. And even though the curve may have not been as crisp as you wanted, it's obvious that he's reached maturity in managing an institution like this. He can demonstrate knowledge on how to identify, how to deter, and prevent these problems. And I think that he's going to bring that management over to the new facility, and everything is going to be just fine over there.
I guess I would point out, in defense of the police department, that we weren't holding calls for service that initiated from staff at that establishment.
You were what?
We were not holding them accountable for calls that they initiated. If they called it in, it was something that we said, good for you, because we didn't want them feeling like they couldn't call it in. So that wasn't held against them.
But, I mean, but...
Do these stats show that?
Right. I mean, it's not going to say...
Well, these stats also don't show that he truly, that the police have not been in his establishment in the last 3 years. I mean, we're taking his word at that.
Okay.
All right? So we're not going to get into a back and forth here, but if you'd like us to have the police department do that kind of research and show out of the last 3 years how many calls were initiated by staff and how many weren't, and how many times police department staff were in that establishment or weren't, we can certainly do that. But I think that's, I don't know if that's, it's. I mean, I've had my say here.
Questions?
No.
Thank you.
Here's the certificates.
Thank you.
Motion to close the floor.
Second.
Motion by Alder Zimmerman to close the floor, second by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion, floor is now closed. I would just like to add that back when we had that semi-judicial hearing, that was the biggest part of the problem that we saw, was that the establishment was afraid to call the police. There was that cultural misunderstanding with this Latino community not wanting to engage with the police, that mistrust, and part of what we encouraged going forward, the change that needed to happen, was to establish that relationship with the police. So I'm glad that happened. Okay.
So I'm really struggling with how I'm going to vote tonight.
Okay.
And eventually I'm going to have to vote. I do know that it's going to go to council. We're going to need a three-quarter vote for this to even move forward. So almost the whole council is going to have to decide.
Might be two-thirds, I don't know.
Or either one.
I don't know what the moratorium.
Eight or nine.
I think
we need to know where these moratoriums are.
Each one has a little different.
And their restrictions.
When we did the establishment for downtown for the wine, we made it a three-fourths. So I don't know if that went all the way.
We did make it a three-fourths.
I don't know if that carries to every, I think we just made that for every moratorium.
We did.
We changed the.
We changed it from two-thirds to three-fourths.
Yeah, we changed the ordinance to.
Because we wanted it to be as strict as possible when we did the wine one, when you were here.
So we changed that to three-fourths.
I'm struggling because I see that there has been, it seems, some improvement and some learning, but I am struggling with the disorderly house that I see here a number of times, the amount of calls, just using up the police resources, and history tends to repeat itself. That's something we've learned. So I can see both sides. In the end, whatever we decide here is going to go to council. And then the whole council's going to have to decide which way we're going to go. But I just want to make the point that I am really struggling with my decision.
Well, Mr. Chairman, as I look at, you know, the most recent things, you know, these other things were from the past here, and sometimes there were two tickets given for really essentially the same thing. Sale of alcohol to an underage person, then allowing an underage person to loiter. Well, it's one and the same. You get two charges for one misconduct, really. And those were back in 2006, 2005. When you look on the list here, since 2012, which is going to be almost 5 years ago, there's only been one. There's only been one. I'm looking at the one from 2012 with the speeding ticket. So really, since 2011, there's only been one violation. That was in 2013, about a little more than 3 years ago. So I don't know. We've given the license for 3 years. It doesn't seem like the major problems have been in really the last 5 years, not just the last three. So I think we should make a motion to approve it. If you want to put some stipulation on it or something
Mr.
like that.
Mr. Chair, Mr. Alder, just wanted to add on the topic of the stipulation, as per counselor's suggestion, staff would recommend as well as PD to put that stipulation in, preventing Mr. Calhoun from being an employee at the establishment. I believe in the beginning of mm-hmm. counselor's presentation, he had indicated that the applicant would be willing to that stipulation.
That your motion?
I don't have a problem with that. I approve it with that stipulation. And I don't, do we want to review it in 6 months to see how things are? And if things are not good, we may plan for a hearing before next year, before the licensing year.
So your motion with those two?
Does it mean we're talking December, when the license come again, what, July 1st? That we have a report back here at our first meeting in May to tell us what the current situation is, and if it's something that really needs to be reviewed in detail before we give up.
That timeline might be more appropriate if we knew when the business would open, so 6 months from the time that the business
opens. We're going to be relicensing again at the end of June.
Right.
Probably the first, probably our second, first mm-hmm. or second meeting in June. Probably okay. First meeting in June, we're going to be doing license. That's why I said if we could have a review of it for our last meeting in May, for instance, and see if we need to do something more before licensing comes up.
Well, if I may, I mean, there was a time when we were having a lot of problems downtown and elsewhere that for a while we asked the police for a monthly report. And we got, so we would be not only keeping track of that business, but all the businesses. And that might be a way we can keep our pulse, the pulse of any problem establishments. And that's why we did it. We wanted to see what the problem establishments were and if they were going to be improving or not, which there was dramatic improvement. Kudos to the police working with the establishments. So that is something we could perhaps do again, is once a month get a report of all the disturbances from the police, if you so desire.
Well, I don't know if you want to just have it every month like that. That's quite a burden, but that's what I'm saying. If we grant it and the council goes along with it, then I think we should take a good review of it by the end of May, is what I'm saying. And so it would be with the stipulation also that the committee will review their record by its second meeting in May. Our second meeting in May.
Okay. Do we want to open the floor to see when he expects to open for business?
I assume it's going to be pretty soon.
Motion to open the floor.
Second.
Aye. Yeah.
By the end of January, by mid-February, somewhere around that month.
Okay, end of January, mid-February. That's a few months ago. Okay. Thank you. Motion to close the floor.
Second. What? Motion to close the floor.
Move. Second.
Okay. Motion by Alder Dorf, second by Alder Galvin.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So we have a motion to approve.
Those conditions.
With the conditions that, I'm sorry, what was the individual?
Andrew James Calhoun will not be an employee at the establishment
or involved in any way, and that by our second meeting in May we'd have
another update. Review, correct.
Okay, second? I'll second. Any further discussion? I think we've talked it out. Let's vote. All in favor? Aye. All opposed?
No.
No.
Okay, so that motion fails at a 2-2 tie. So, but it will go to council. Since it is in a moratorium area, it will require 3/4 vote. You might want to be there. There might be some discussion on this. Yeah, so, thank you. Consideration with possible action and request by Alder Zimmer that the city consider prohibiting the sale of single cans or bottles of beer and single small bottles of alcohol.
With your permission, Mr. Chairman, certainly. Could we take number 11 before we take 10? They've been sitting here for 2 hours.
Yeah.
And this one is just more amongst ourselves.
Okay, well, I'll take a motion to amend the agenda.
Make a motion we take second. Number 11 out of order now.
Okay, motion to take 11 now, seconded by Alder Zimmer, seconded by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I was looking at one of your predecessors that's been waiting here for 2 hours, so.
Okay, so we will now take item number 11. Consideration with possible action on a request by Alder Zimmer on behalf of all the licensed taxi cabs in the city that the city allow and encourage all licensed taxi cabs who line up on the north side of Lombardi Avenue between Ridge Road and Oneida Street to help clear the people who need transportation after all Packer games.
Yeah, just for introduction, our people would like to speak to this, but my sense was that, you know, that north side of the street there are like three buses that sit there. We want to clear the area as fast as we can. And I don't see any reason why there couldn't be taxi cab drivers. Probably handle 20 or more, 30 or more taxi cabs along there. to help clear that area and, you know, acknowledge our licensed people that they're there to do a service for us. I know this is related to this request, but it isn't what I have exactly on the agenda, but I have a concern that, you know, we have all kinds of people coming as far away as Milwaukee to come here to grab onto whatever business they can get. And I don't think they get licenses from here, and they're probably violating our laws, but, you know, our police are heavily involved in traffic and stadium business. You know, they don't have time to put the tag on people that are operating illegal here. So I'm thinking, but this would be something easy to control. In other words, if they get to be licensed people, that's easy to check when they're all in a line there. And I think that would do something to help boost the legitimate people who are paying taxes and paying licenses to the city of Green Bay, and at the same time help as a service to get as many people out of the area as quickly as possible. So that was the intention of my motion. That's a little of the background about it. But I personally think it would be a good idea. That space there is not hindering anything, and I think that would be a boost to the business and boost to the city helping clear the area faster.
Staff, does Hef have any, is there a reason why we haven't, take it they cannot park there now, I'm assuming?
Well, right now, they have it blocked off, you know, with big trucks and that. The whole street is blocked off from Ridge Road down to Oneida. Mm-hmm. And then a little before is it right at the end of the game or a little before the end, they move it and open it up. But only as right now, the only one who's permitted to park in that area there is the three or four buses that are used to help all people out of there. And I think, you know, at the end of game time, licensed people come there, what's going to hurt to have them line up there and get people as fast as possible out of the area?
Has the police considered this at all?
We would actually not be in favor of this for a number of reasons, and I'm not familiar with the buses there, so I apologize, I can't speak on that.
Are they the city buses?
Yes.
But as part of the Department of Homeland Security and the target-rich environment that Lambeau Field provides, Lombardi Avenue is blocked off from Ridge Road to Oneida during the game time and immediately after the game time to comply with the Department of Homeland Security requirements to prevent various terroristic acts from driving into that area and causing problems. Also, there's a mad rush of people after a game time, and that's also used as a crossing area to get to the neighborhood locations where streets are filled with parked cars and such. Private properties are filled with parked cars. So that would be a traffic issue and a safety issue to have all these pedestrians in the same area where we have mobile vehicles. There are no sidewalks on that street, on Lombardi Avenue in that particular area, so you wouldn't really be able to have pedestrian traffic getting to those cabs where they would be allowed to stop safely. Furthermore, on Ridge Road there is a taxi cab location where cabs are allowed to park currently and pick up their people as it stands now. With the addition of the Titletown district starting next year, the whole traffic flow is going to change, and if we would change the ordinance to accommodate this one, maybe two final games of this year, we'd be sitting back here again next year making that ordinance change to accommodate the Titletown district that's being built as we see. So those are a number of the reasons the police department would be not be in favor of allowing taxis, and nor could we really allow taxis to park on Lombardi during that immediate time right after a game per the Department of Homeland Security.
Well, I guess if there's licensed people, those are people we've vetted already, and we do have buses there. We have special buses that help get people out of there that are parking there. So I'm assuming that people come across the street there to get on those, because as you said, there's no sidewalk on that side of the street. But what, how many cross, there's no cross street there at all, is there?
There's a couple cross areas to allow people to get to Shadow Lane, and the streets parallel to Lombardi on the north side.
It's all fenced along there, isn't it?
There's a couple openings where people can...
some people can cut through the yards, sir?
Yeah, there's a city of sidewalks that go through there to allow pedestrian traffic to get...
So they can cross over Lombardi in the middle of the block?
They do. At the end of a game, that's exactly what happens. Okay.
So what would be the problem if they hired a taxi that was sitting there?
Well, as I mentioned, because of the Department of Homeland Security requirements...
They don't apply to the buses?
We have that street blocked off. And I can't say about these buses. I'm not familiar with the buses.
If the buses are allowed there at a certain point as the game progresses, would we not be able to allow taxis to ingress that area at the same time? So, I mean, if there's a rule, and I don't know what it is, say 2 minutes, at the 2 minute mark, we allow the city buses to come in and start picking up people. Wouldn't we also be able to allow the taxi cabs to come in at the same time?
If they're searched, and I can only imagine that maybe that's what the buses are being searched.
Well, because once the game's over, who cares if there's no one cares that those buses haven't been searched, right? Correct?
I apologize, I don't have that information.
Well, I guess I understand. We block off Lombardi Avenue, and it's locked down, and nobody goes in there unless they're searched during the game. At some point, those buses come in there and park and prepare to take people out of the area. I don't know if they're searched or not. I would imagine if they are searched and the taxi cabs are willing to be searched, we could do some accommodation like that. But if the buses don't come in till a certain mark during the game and they're not searched, then I don't know why we would restrict the cabs from coming in.
And I can only add that maybe these buses are parked at a location in Lombardi far enough away from the stadium that allows them to do so.
Well, so
they're on the north side of the street there.
They're right there.
Right there on the north side
of
the street. It's about as far away from the stadium as you can get without being in somebody's yard.
But I think we got to answer these questions before we can make a decision.
Well, Homeland Security, who establishes those barriers? Who made all these rules? Homeland Security?
Correct.
Well, yeah, I guess we have a higher authority. We need to talk.
Well, I don't know. Then how come the buses are allowed in there then?
Maybe they shouldn't be, for one thing.
Well,
maybe they're being searched.
Well, maybe they've been, you know.
Well, I guess I would ask.
Well, and the police department would know if they're being searched.
Well, and he's not.
He may not be part of that process. I mean, it's a huge process. I guess I would ask that staff, police department, look into everything that's involved with those buses being in there and to see if we could also allow cabs to go through the same protocols the buses go through and park on the north side of the street.
I can look into that.
Licensed, you know.
Well, I
tell you, I'm really kind of steamed about the people who don't take out licenses and come here from distances away and are hauling people around and illegally hauling people around. We have no understanding about them, and this is nothing to do with the Uber thing. That's a whole different ball game that I find ridiculous too. But this is just for this. I mean, I think we should try to do something if we can. I mean, if it's absolutely, you know, against all protocol and law, then I stand amended. You know, I don't want to break the law.
Don't want to take on Homeland Security.
Is it? I guess I would ask: is it against state statute or city ordinance for cabs licensed outside of the Green Bay area to come in and ply their trade?
Not that I'm aware of. I think they can operate outside, but
whether they're licensed or not, or just so they're licensed somewhere?
They have to be licensed somewhere, I believe.
Could you find that also?
We can look into that
for our next meeting?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm pretty sure they got to be licensed to operate here.
Unless they're an
Uber operation, and they got a whole different set of rules. So.
Yeah. Uber me this.
It was stated that there is an area for cabs right now on Ridge.
On South Ridge Road is the current taxi stand for.
And that.
But that's just one little area. I mean, we're trying to get more people out as quickly as possible, and
how big area
also
are we talking
help
about?
Boost our local economy.
I guess I would also ask staff to find out how much area is available for cabs on Ridge Road. You know, if it's 2, 20, 100. If they could find that out for us also.
And if there's any way to perhaps expand on that.
Yeah.
Well, there's people been waiting here to get to address this. I'd make a motion to open the floor to give some interest to parties.
Second.
Motion by Alder Zoo to open the floor, seconded by Alder Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Floor is now open if you care to come forward and speak on this. Please state your name and address, and then just address me as the chair, please.
Okay. Julie Arnoldi, 511 Clover Lane, Green Bay, Wisconsin. And as far as the Ridge Road, that is for anybody. There's coach buses, there's everything. We talk to these people. They want to drive in the cabs. They don't want to ride in the buses full of people. They've been drinking. Some of them have kids. Some of them want to go someplace else. They want to be in the cabs, and they can't find us. There's trash in front of us that's lined up all along the side of Ridge Road. Sometimes it's hard for them to see us. It's hard for them to locate us. We go over by the stadium view. The way we're going right now, I personally come up and around and have to go back through the back roads. There's people walking on the streets. We could get rid of twice as many people, five times faster, if we had access the same as the buses. We wouldn't protest at all to checking the vans. We worked hard on our image with Yellow Cab. If we have a blinker out, it's replaced within an hour. 9th Street Auto owns it. We've taken really good care of it. Everything's licensed. We have the insurance that we were required. And Rod said that if this would be something that would go through, that he's the owner, that we would actually pay for a Yellow Cab taxi sign. We currently have 18 vans that we can use, and we'd be happy to put the sign in place. You can tell us what it would cost.
Something you can look at if we get that far.
Well, you know, 18 vans could help clear the area. I mean, we're talking hundreds of thousands of people, but a lot of people bring their own car or whatever. But.
Questions? Okay, yeah. I think the inspection would probably be more for security reasons than actual, you know,
right.
Lights and stuff.
I find that just kind of over the top. That area on Ridge Road is closer to the stadium than Lombardi Avenue is. And so I just think we should take an honest look at this and try to, you know, that, why are we just losing all that good space there? Why aren't we utilizing it?
People aren't even seeing it. It depends on which gate they're coming out of. So a lot of them are coming out of the side gates. If they're coming out on the other side, they're not seeing. Or if they're coming out of the front, they can. But it's also, there's buses over there. There's limousines over there. There was a big coach bus over there. There was an officer standing right there. It was blocking the driveway for when people were coming out. He never said a word about it. We're in the stand. We have people are picking up people personally. We have limousines in there with us. We have to try to squeeze in. The officers are great as far as directing us across. We have to cross the traffic that's coming up Ridge to go all the way across, because we come through the Kroll's parking lot and come in. A lot of times we get blocked off there by limousines, coach buses, cars.
Maybe we can look at this and figure out.
I'm just thinking that's such a natural place to
pick up
a lot of people.
Staff, too.
If there's a designated taxi.
Well, let's wait. Just any questions for her? We can just save that rest for discussion. So any other questions?
Well, I guess, is this designated area on Ridge Road, is this for cabs only?
No,
they're allowing anybody.
No. I'm not asking what they're allowing. Is your understanding it's supposed to be for cabs only?
I thought so.
Okay.
But there's illegal cabs. There's everything.
Yeah. We're looking into that, too. Okay,
yeah.
So.
Uber.
Yeah.
There's Ubers there.
Yeah.
Behind Shawnee Avenue. That guy's been living there for 4 to 5 years. He's got a Chicago cab. Nothing happens with him. He comes down here. He's down here for every game. Now there's one that's a squad car on half and yellow on the other half. That one ran the game.
That's
we
our car,
had
isn't it?
Appleton taxi down here this weekend.
That's our car, I think.
Please go.
Half squad, half.
Yeah.
That's our car.
Okay. I've seen that down here. Yeah, and I saw that running today, too.
See, it works. You see it.
I saw you. So I seen that. You know, there's a lot of different vehicles that don't have the stickers on them that are running and picking up people after the games. And my concern is, even with the Uber, I'm barely going to touch that. Mm-hmm. People don't know who Uber is and who's not. There are people, I was at Quick Trip, was filling up gas, and this guy came up, and he's, $20 for a ride anywhere you want to go. I said, are you Uber? He said, no. He said, what does it matter to you? I said, because if they get in that car, I'm calling the police right now. He was up and out of there, and I had my phone up like this, and then he was gone. But you have regular people coming and trying to pick up people, especially out of town people, and I'm just afraid something's going to happen, because it's going to.
Hmm. Anything else? Okay, thank you. In just a minute then, Celestine Jeffries, did you have?
I do. I texted Director Kiewiz from Green Bay Metro about the...
Buses,
yes. She responded, all buses are searched and secured before accessing Lombardi Avenue. Once the road is open, they are no longer searched. This is typically 50 minutes after the game.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else wish to speak on this? Please.
And there a little nepotism here?
State your name and address, and then just address me as the chair, please.
Teresa Miller, 1212 South Maple. Home address, 1434 Traeger. I'm currently one of the owners of Yellow Cab. And just to let you know, just to deviate a bit from the initial statements made was, if you go on Craigslist, you know, it's branching out. This, since Uber came into town, there are people advertising on Craigslist for rides. So they're deviating from Uber, the initial, what Uber's supposed to be doing, down to that. And if it came down to it, you want to search Yellow Cabs, open door policy.
Thanks.
Questions?
No. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you can come.
Carl Arnoldy, 817 Lincoln Street, Green Bay. I'm not a cab driver, but I'm just listening to this here. I'm listening. My daughter was a cab driver, and I hear the stuff where we got out of town taxi cabs coming in there. We got unlicensed people coming in there doing it. With the Yellow Cab, at least we know they're licensed, they're clean, and the city has some control. We don't have any control over these other people coming in. And as far as the Homeland Security searching vehicles, they don't search a single car coming in there. You know, Come on. Okay, we're searching the buses before they come in, but we're not searching them after the game. We're searching before the game. I just think it's a good thing to allow licensed people from Green Bay, a business in Green Bay, to allow access to the Bridge Road. Thank you.
Well, just wait. Question? Question. Okay, thank you.
Howard Utter, 2126 Herald Street, Green Bay. I've been a cab driver in this town for 18 years with Yellow Cab. Since they let Uber and everybody in here, they come from Illinois, they come from Chicago, they come from all over. You got people out in Howard bringing their cars down to the game, making money, making their own fares up. This is, you know, we have nowhere to go. They brought the city buses in to pick up our fares. Our wages are going down, 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 and we have nowhere to go. Whether it be the game or downtown. They made it so we can't park down on Washington Street. Therefore, we pull over for a minute to pick somebody up, they give us a ticket.
Can't park on Washington Street?
Mm-hmm. Not on Friday or Saturday nights. I believe there's a certain time period that they don't allow any parking on Washington Street.
It reduces some of the disturbances.
All right, but this would be like standing parking kind of thing, right? Not parking. I mean, you're not leaving your vehicle, right? You're just picking up a fare.
They're just,
ticketed, right?
We've had four drivers ticketed just pulling over. Somebody flagged them down.
We're not allowed to over it.
Wait, you're telling me a guy stood on the sidewalk, went like this, the cab
pulled over
to
pick him up.
And in 30 seconds, a cop was there giving him a ticket?
Yes, sir.
Wow, these guys are good.
I'm going to be honest with you. I'm finding that pretty hard to believe.
Trish, am I lying?
No.
The police are usually there on Washington Street.
Yep.
So as soon as they see a yellow cab pull over, the ticket comes out.
Wait, pull over or picking up a fare?
Picking up, I'm sorry. As soon as somebody goes to the side, somebody will be like, hey, a cab. And then all
so our police department is not allowing cabs to pull to the side of the road and pick up fares?
No, but they'll let a car pull over and pick them up.
Sad.
Well, car, you don't know if it's somebody who knows the person or whatever, but just the same.
Uber.
It seems that, yeah. Seems that.
I guess I'd like to have the chief look into that and let us know. There's a lot of things I think we need to have checked into on this, but before we digress too much.
I can just give you, it's part of discussion.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead, come forward again. Just state your name.
Julie Arnoldy. I just want to say, too, as far as our protection and everything, Yellow Cab does have a computer system. Every single run that we do is documented. We all pay taxes. They can look at the screen. They can see where every single cab is. They can see where a person called from, how close we are to getting them. This is something they've had implemented for quite a few years. I wanted to say that this is a safe thing. We look out for the safety. And, I mean, if you had a robbery on Shawnee Street, you could call and say, was there a cab that picked somebody up? And the police department does call us. And I want to say, too, that we are safe because when something happens, the police department does call us to pick up somebody if it's a disturbance or and nobody's going to jail or, you know, if they're releasing somebody, if somebody's walking on the bridge. We have served the police department, too. So to say that we're not as good as the bus system, which we've been doing the Packer game for many, many years, isn't fair because we've all had our background checked. Yellow Cab, at any time, they can walk in and check that. You have a great system and a great place, so I'd like to keep it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else on this?
Return to regular order business.
Second.
Motion by Alder Zimmerman to return. Seconded by Alder Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
We're back in business.
Well, I, Mr. Chairman, I tell you, if they're allowed to, on Ridge Road, which is closer to the stadium, and Lombardi is here, well, what's the problem? Why aren't we encouraging it? And I'm especially interested in having licensed people that we know, that the drivers are licensed, the cab companies are licensed, the fares are listed, people are being treated fairly, etc. Why would Homeland Security be any more concerned about Lombardi Avenue than they would be Ridge Road, which is even closer to the stadium? So I don't know. I guess I'd want, in all fairness, that be checked a little bit. And, you know, if they can come there, there's no reason why an officer can't check. I don't know what the heck they'd be checking for. Terrorists got a bomb in the taxi? I don't know. But when we have all licensed people there and their licenses are pasted right on the dashboards and fares are all there, I don't see why we can't accommodate this. And I want us to do things that will help promote our local business that follow all of our rules to the letter of the law. They have license, they get insurance, they have their drivers put together. I didn't even know some of the things that they do. It sounds like they have just excellent records. If police ever had to do a follow-up on anything, they've got a perfect record. And I know concerning that business downtown, and that's a whole different subject that maybe we'll want to put it on for separate discussion.
I think so.
But I did see where somebody had a fare 1 minute, a fare was paid, was registered in the system, and 1 minute later, within one minute later, they got a ticket. And I did follow up on it. And I was told that, well, that person had been there earlier in the day and the officer saw it but didn't give a ticket. And then when he decided to give it to him later on when he saw him come back. So, I mean, at this point, you know, they're just not allowed to go and sit in certain areas to look for rides. I don't particularly know why. Maybe it's creating too much congestion. I don't know. I don't know what the rationale is for it. But I do know that they have a very strong system that could be a a benefit to the police if there ever was anything wrong with it. So I think if there's a way we can help promote our own business and also help serve the people of the stadium, I think we should try to do it. So I don't know if, what's her, how long would it take to research this?
Okay.
The legalization of it.
Well,
we got to check with Homeland Security, I think, and we got to check, the police have a few things to check out.
Right. I'd like, yeah, I'd like to hold this, and then so the police department can check with Homeland Security. They can check to see about the designated cab area, if it's for cabs only or any other kind of license livery thing. If cabs from outside, licensed from outside the area, can operate within the city limits. And if they can't, I guess that's something else we need to look at. So kind of a little laundry list of things.
For a whole new discussion. Those are all separate discussions.
Right, but I mean, you know, the designated area, you know, I mean, if it's merely because we're not doing our job kicking out other vehicles, you know, which would make it easier for the cabbies to get in their spot.
Well, I don't know that the police have the time for it at that particular time. You know, it's really a tough situation for the police and everybody.
That's going to be the same thing if they get on the Lombardi and they have to be searched.
Here is something. I mean, if it, Patty emailed here or
texted
the sales team that they just need to have people check the vehicles. Well, I don't think that would be very hard to do at all. And here we'd have a stand for probably 20, 30 vehicles.
That's all they do.
That would help them. So if we can give is there any reason why we can't do a motion, you know, subject to review by the police department for, you know, legality of it? But I assume it's legal because buses are there. It's just a matter of checking them. And that we recommend that to the council. We do have maybe one or, how many home games we got yet? Two, huh? Or one. So, and then we were hoping for more, right?
Where we got one, we got, yeah. Yeah. Well, I don't know if this would be set to go by, I mean, we need to get information back to the committee to make a recommendation to council. I don't think we can send this out.
Contingent upon okay by the police department. I mean, let's try to accommodate it if we can. If there's something too complex, they'll tell us by the 20th here, by council meeting.
Well,
not any problem, Chief?
We can certainly get our part done by the 20th, sir.
And if there's a problem, we can pull
it sooner. They have to get it done by the 15th or the 16th in order for it to get on the council agenda, right? It's not by the 20th, it's by the end of this week. They have to get that done.
Thursday, I think, is their cutoff.
Thursday is the
Thursday
cutoff.
Afternoon.
Yeah.
No. It would be on our, they would put it on our agenda.
What?
It would go to our agenda. It would be on the agenda. We would know by the 20th if it's okay from the police. If it's okay from the police, we can let it go. If it's not okay, I will pull it.
Okay.
And send it back.
You want to do it like that?
So I make a motion that we grant that approval subject to concurrence with the police department and let the department let us know by council time whether it should be referred back or not.
Okay. Should I direct that to the chairman?
Yes, please.
Our information that we get.
Okay, second.
Well, I'll second that, but also are we going to have them check into that designated area on Ridge Road?
Yep, that'll be part of the report.
And then about the unlicensed, because we got to have 100 people show up with licensed cabs from all over who knows where, saying, hey, there's no ordinance against it, we need to get in on Lombardi Avenue, and then what do we do?
I think we're going to restrict this to licenses we know, the ones that pass through the city of Green Bay. This area would just be for Green Bay
licensed
taxi cab drivers. We're not going to.
So, not Ubers or.
No, no.
Why would
Green
we take
Bay licensed
chances?
Cab.
Not Howard Swamico, not.
No, Green Bay licensed cab.
From
Lombardi.
We'll
just, for now, we can always tweak it later.
Sure. Okay. I'm comfortable with that.
So, you wanted to second it?
Second it.
You don't want to fight over it?
No. Just give another.
Motion made by Alder Zima, seconded by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, so there's a motion open the floor again?
Sure.
This is subject to the council approving it on the 20th.
Motion to open the floor.
Just one second.
Second.
Okay, motion open the floor by Oliver Gavin, seconded by Oliver Dorf. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Please. Just state your name one more time.
Howard Utter. Just to give you an example, you want to get drunks off the street, set up a taxi stand downtown, one on the south end and one on the north end. That way the cabs could sit there and pick the drunks up off the street. They wouldn't have to search for a cab. As it is now, if you go to stop to pick somebody up, you're going to get ticketed. It's just a suggestion.
Yep, okay, thank you.
I think the chairman's going to put this discussion of these other items on the agenda.
Agenda, yep, I'll. So thank you. Well, we haven't closed the floor, we haven't closed it yet.
Hey, don't buy it back.
Okay, just your name one more time, please.
Julie Arnoldi.
Okay.
There was a comment made about Uber letting them in and everything else. I'm just going to encourage, we have had our cars inspected.
We've already voted.
We already voted, and we said no.
Oh, okay, good.
They got to be licensed by the city of Green Bay.
Yep.
We said licensed, right.
Yep.
Motion to close.
That's in the motion, licensed by the city of Green Bay.
Yep. Motion to close the floor by Alder Dorf.
Second.
Second by Alder Galvin, all in favor?
Aye.
Floor is now closed. Did we vote on that last motion yet, or no?
Yeah, we did.
We did, so it's all behind us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, okay. Cost me a nickel.
Digging breakers on?
Do we want to take a 5-minute break?
If that's okay with you guys, otherwise just keep going and I'll catch up.
Motion to take a 5-minute break?
So moved.
All in favor?
Second, aye.
Okay, we're breaking for 5 minutes.
Police calls in an area, et cetera, for places that don't have this in high density areas and neighborhoods.
Just want to make sure you.
But the chief said that the nuisance problems, he wanted to put on some extra help and report back to us. And if he thought that this extra help had solved the problem and make a recommendation to us about it one way or the other. Have I misstated anything, Chief?
No, sir.
So, if that, you know, and again, it comes with the item earlier on our agenda. I know it's not a popular item. Because, you know, I do witness them, there's ways around everything. But I haven't heard from, I haven't met with the chief yet, so I'm interested in his report, but there's, I really think we ought to address it in some way. Those little small bottles, you know, we hear about grandma getting one to do her baking or something with a 1-ounce thing. People buying these are generally are not that type of people. And not saying they can't be sold, but maybe they should be sold in bulk or something like that for people that might be wanting to buy them. But boy, usually those sort of things are restricted to like liquor stores. And their whole business is that.
Okay. Should we say that? For
and
respect?
So I guess, you know, I'm not opposed to liquor stores dispensing them. That's their whole livelihood. They are not like a supermarket or convenience store that just applies, that has a lot of lower wage workers with high turnover of staff, so that keeping competent staff is difficult. The liquor stores, that's their business. I feel they are legitimate to dispense this. To have it for every Tom, Dick, and Harry.
Please. So. I think that's for discussion. If we could just hear from the police chief. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you. Alder Zima, I think, you know, couched it pretty well on June 6th that we discussed this, and I was asked to make a recommendation, and the recommendation was whether we should eliminate the sales, single sales in the city. We talked about what the issues were in the city and the reason why people were looking for this, and a couple things that were brought up were the public intoxicants and inebriates that were in different areas of the city, people that were panhandling, people that were lying around other people's lawns, urinating, and the other problem was the trash and the litter that people were depositing around these establishments and in the neighborhoods, and that was a concern for some folks. So I ask that we get a chance to take a look at it ourselves and to do some work on it over the course of the following 6 months and to see if we as a police department could have some kind of an impact in the quality of life and and maybe make a difference in those areas before we make a recommendation or not on whether we should ban those things as far as the police department's concerned. So we did a couple things. One is that we started walking footbeats in those areas, and we'd go out with as many as a dozen officers at a time and walk footbeats through those areas and meet with the neighbors and talk to the folks that were out there. We selected three new senior lead officers or community policing officers for that area. We picked folks that were dedicated, they competed for those spots knowing that they were going to be working in that area, and they have a strong desire to improve the quality of life in those neighborhoods. One of them even grew up in a neighborhood just south of the area we were really concerned about. I personally walked probably a dozen different times footbeats with different people from the community. Alderman Scanlon was out there at least once or twice with us, and we would do inspections of the neighborhoods, and we would look and see what kind of litter and what kind of debris was out there and whether we saw these intoxicants and these inebriants. We met with our senior lead officer, community policing officers, met with members of the business community in the area, and we let them know that it was their responsibility to keep the grounds around their businesses clean. And in fact, they did do that. They went out and they started sweeping up their lots, and they started picking up trash from the areas around there. So by the time we did many of our footbeats, even with the people who were making complaints, we had a hard time even finding some liquor bottles. If you recall, one of the walks we went through the neighborhood, I think in maybe in 45-minute walk, we found maybe one or two bottles or cans in the entire neighborhood in one of the areas that was indicated to us to be one of the biggest problem areas. So one of the other things we wanted to do is kind of see what kind of scope of the problem we had. So we changed our computer system so that whenever an officer has encountered someone with an open container, or when an officer got a call of someone, a radio call of someone with an open container, we put a special designation called single serve in there so that we could query it later and find out how many of these cases there were. We had the officers ask the person where they purchased the liquor, whether it was a single serving container, whether it was multiple containers or not. In the total cases that we got in the area we were talking about was right around 40, with a total of 48 offenders. So there was obviously a couple occasions where there were groups of people hanging around. About 50% of those people that we stopped and we queried and who would talk to us and had alcohol on them that we could identify as possible single serve. The other people that had alcohol was either they had a 12-pack with them, they had a 6-pack with them, they had a 4-pack with them, or they had a single bottle of whiskey. You know, a larger bottle of whiskey or a larger bottle of half liter of vodka is one of the things they talked about here. We reinvigorated our no serve list. So we took that around to all the different alcohol sellers in this area, made sure it was updated with all the current people that we had that were known inebriates that were on that voluntary no serve list. And we made sure that the people in each of those establishments had a picture of the person that was on the no serve list. So that they could self-police, and they were pretty good about that. We met monthly with the Tavern League as part of our drunk driving enforcement program. Met monthly with them and talked about the problems that we were having and see if there's anything they could do to assist us with that. We ended up writing a total of, I think I tallied 11 different citations for littering. Now, littering citations are they're easy to write, but they're pretty tough to see. You have to actually see the person toss in something to write it. So we got 11 littering citations. We looked at where people purchased the alcoholic beverages that they were when they were subject of one of these radio calls. And the people that would admit to it or talk to us said the number one place was the CVS Pharmacy over on Main. Well, I went over to CVS Pharmacy and I talked to some of the management over there about whether single serving was an issue with them. And they were the opinion that it seems like the folks that would were coming in there that were the inebriates were buying the 12 packs of the low end, the lower quality alcohol and bringing those out and not buying the single serving. That was the opinion that they had. So we looked at all that. We had a total of, one individual was a frequent flyer. We were adding him to a list. He, as you can see in the items in red, there were a couple people with multiple stops or arrests, all of which were homeless folks. The guy in the top, we found six times.
Oh, yeah. Your staff has got to catch up with you.
Okay, all right.
You've been consumed by the previous items.
Yeah, that's right. Probably still taking notes. So if you look at the people that we stopped, that we identified that were not on our no-serve list, that had multiple offenses.
Which page are you on?
On the very first page, it says single serving, and I'm looking at the folks that's with the names in red right here. One individual we stopped and detained or cited a total of six times. He, of course, was added to the no-serve list after we found out that he was going to be one of our frequent flyers. So our idea is that we want to you know, get that no-serve list and keep that no-serve list as active as we can, and hope that that'll help us control the problems in the downtown area. And you can see in the downtown area, if you look at the little marks on the bottom or on the bottom of the map, those are the locations that seem to be problematic, so we wanted to focus on that area. I met with some of the folks from some of the establishments on the far sides of town, the festivals, the quick trips, and places like that, and even the neighbors in those areas, and I didn't really hear any complaints or any concerns that they would have over single sales or inebriation area in the more sparsely populated areas of the city. So, locations the alcohol was purchased, again, we met with those folks and talked to them and see if there's anything we can do there. We walked plenty of footbeats and spent plenty of time in those neighborhoods. And I think the thing that really helped us most was meeting with the business owners and getting them to self-police and getting them to clean up their own areas surrounding their businesses. I think that was the most helpful. So, you know, whether you guys decide or not to ban single serves throughout the city or just in particular places, based on the calls which we've had, I had zero calls to my office with people having concerns from that. Based on the concerns talking to the folks in the community, at this time, I can't recommend that we do a citywide ban on single serves. I think, certainly not from a police perspective. If you have other issues with the quality of life in different neighborhoods and people don't want those items sold in their neighborhoods, that's again something for you all to consider as a board. But as far as numbers of police calls and volume of police problems, it doesn't seem to warrant it this time.
Yes, sir.
I think your study shows, and you know, it's a decent sample for about how many months did you?
We started on June 19th, and the figures that you have go through November 29th, so just a little bit over 6 months.
Okay, right, very close to 6 months. And it shows that where you did detect them, we can't be everywhere all the time, but where you did find them, it was mostly the inner city.
Correct.
And I think that was our neighborhood groups that I've talked to, the individuals who are concerned about it, that's what we're talking about. Older areas, higher density of people that have no, I noted that here, they're all homeless. These are the people wandering around our inner city. And so it's those areas that, and that's why I'm not so concerned about BP station out in, road out by the university there.
Huron or one of those, Ontario?
It's not that. It's really to try to help aid our inner city so that we don't have these type of people finding their way around. And maybe they'll look for some other city to live in. I really don't want to welcome people that are just coming here to abuse our hospitality in Green Bay. So I mean, I'm satisfied with, you know, we did ban three of them in neighborhoods on the west side. Mr. Scanlon, I think you, was it you or Mr. Nenig, has the east side over here. But I think it's those areas that we should put the ban on to, if we decide to do it at all, or do you want to continue having officers, because we're using time and resources to better police these areas. Now, I'm happy, if you want to tell me that you're going to continue doing that, I'm happy to say, I guess if you think we should just leave no single serve there, I'll live with that because I think you're doing a good job. I mean, obviously, of course, it coincided a little bit with the closing of the liquor store. We no more than started this at the liquor store over there on
Walnut
yes, sir. And Maple shut down. And I know I had some comments that things were picked up right away because they weren't being able to attach that. And there were a lot of single sales in there.
Yes, sir.
But so I don't know. I'm of two minds about it to the committee. I'm not just adamantly in favor of a ban on single sales, but I really feel just getting the alcohol out of the inner city.
But a question for the chief?
Might answer your question, sir, if I could. I fully intend to have our officers continue this this type of enforcement, this type of high visibility in that area, this type of walking foot beats, because it sure seems like it's effective. It's a great way to work with the community, and getting the store owners and the shop owners to assist us with keeping the neighborhood clean is one of the directions I give the senior lead officers that have been selected for that area. So yes, we definitely intend to continue to do this. In winter, it's less of a problem. I think when the snow melts and all the trash that's been thrown during the winter comes to light, we'll have to do a big neighborhood cleanup over there. So we're already working on that as a plan for sometime in the spring when the snow starts to go, so we can start from a clean slate again and keep monitoring it throughout the spring and summer.
Do you have an opinion about the sale of hard alcohol in the inner city? I mean, because I've been voting against those licenses, and the council also did.
Yeah. You mean single serve hard liquor?
Well, it's related to that, because we're talking about allowing liquor sales, not only single
right,
serve.
But we could get his opinion on that when we address that particular one, because that will be coming back to us.
Well, they are related here. I really think it all fits together. The single serve, really, if you didn't have the liquor there in the first place, then it's just beer. It's, I think, less of a problem. They get drunk quicker with the hard liquor.
But we just wanted to just focus on single serve.
I guess
now,
if you just maybe comment on the difference between the two.
You know, just looking at the numbers of, I think we documented a dozen different kinds of alcohol here. Two of the 12 that you see, one is the whiskey, which came along with Milwaukee's the Milwaukee beer, and then the other is a vodka, the guy who had the vodka, as well as a couple cans of beer. It seems like the huge, if there is a problem, it seems like it's the high gravity or alcohol fortified malt liquor types of drinks that we see seem to be the most popular amongst people that are drinking and hanging out on streets and in alleys. It's the Steel Reserve, it's the fortified malt liquor type drinks would be the most popular.
So the elevated beer sales, the malt liquors.
Yes, sir. Just in terms of anecdotal and in terms of what we see these gentlemen drinking out there.
Alder Dorf?
Okay, so my question is, I'm looking at the list you gave us, mm-hmm. and there are the names of the six homeless individuals, and is it accurate that when I add those numbers up, that was 18 of the 40 offenses were by a group of six people?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's almost half of the offenses were
regulars
by six people.
Yes, ma'am.
And addressing those six people to me would make more sense than to, you know,
which we'll do by adding them to the no serve list, so that they'll at least be on the no serve list. Now that doesn't going to stop them, as Captain Galvin noted, that we see people walk blocks and blocks and miles if they're really in need of liquor and they can't get served at one of these establishments abiding by the no serve list. So
I wanted that clarification.
Yes,
because
ma'am.
It just seemed like that's a would be a small number of individuals to cause me to eliminate single serve.
Right. One of the other things that we're doing is we're hoping to start up a mental health unit, because a lot of these individuals that are homeless out on our streets and under the influence of alcohol also have mental health issues. So we're hoping that by enacting our mental health unit of two officers, which we posted today, that those officers will be able to address people like this with the long-term solutions, as opposed to giving a guy a ticket or getting him to sober up and having him be right back out on the street. We're hoping that they can work towards more long-term solutions with our social service agencies.
Thank you.
That's it. And I would agree.
Question?
Okay, my question is, are you currently working with, like, say, St. John's Homeless Shelter and then the day treatment center that they've established? Because my experience was it's more than six. We're probably looking at anywhere from 40 to 80 individuals. It's not homeless people. It's individuals with mental health or alcohol addiction issues that become homeless because of it. So we're not saying it's homeless. It's just these individuals happen to be homeless on top of it due to their alcohol issues.
Co-occurring.
Yes. But establishing more of a program, and that's a great start with the mental health officers, I think that's going to pay dividends going forward. But establishing, like you said, some protocols with the mental health center, BCCTC, and then also with St. John's and some of those day treatment centers, if I think that would solve more of these issues that we're seeing in our community than just banning
the sales, because from I'm looking here, you're seeing malt liquor, but I also think you see a lot of beer here too, and not just single serving, but six packs, 12 packs, everything else. So unless we're going to ban all liquor in certain areas, these individuals are still going to get it. I think it's more interacting with them is how I think our problems are going to be solved.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more about working with the social service agencies. You know, it's chronic alcoholism when you have combined with a mental health disorder. It's a tough case to crack. So any help we can get and any time we can partner with St. John's or anyone else, is I think it's time well spent.
I have a question.
It just appears, at least these that you identified as repeat offenders, I note that their ages go from 47 to 63, so these are people have histories of alcoholism. This isn't the 18 to 24 or 18 to 30 year old crowd.
That's this correct.
These are chronic people.
Yep.
And they find their way to Green Bay, I think, because we have a lot of services available.
They may be homegrown, you don't know, but anyway.
Well,
it's an assumption, but
that's just my view of it. I'm just discussing things, and if you want to say something to the contrary later, I'm glad to hear about it.
Oh.
But you know, it's Mr. Galvin says he thinks the pool is much larger than this, and I realize that this is a limited snapshot of the whole problem, but I think it's probably indicative of the larger problem. You didn't really find young people.
No, the young people weren't a problem. You know, in general, I would say that's the case.
So you're gonna continue the program because you think it has, you know, maybe the single serve isn't gonna do it all by itself. It might help, but isn't gonna do it by itself. So you feel we should continue with the police reviewing those areas.
Yes, sir. And partner
I'm welcoming that with open arms. We used to have beat cops in Green Bay a long time ago, mm-hmm. and I always thought we should never gotten rid of them. And I think we're trying to do that with our, you know, community police and everything else. So, mm-hmm. I still feel that.
Is there a question though? We can save that for discussion.
No, thank you, sir.
Okay. I just have one question. When this was implemented at the beginning, there was some discussion of also private group funding. Workers to do cleanups?
Yes, sir.
Was that ever implemented?
It was not yet implemented. We did meet with them. The suggestion was they would hire folks from a certain community shelter around here and pay them to go out and do this cleanup. Last time I checked with the shelter, that's something that's been put on temporary hold. Maybe we'll look at the spring. That might be a good time to get something like that started. It's the spring of the year when we need to do that big cleanup. And I think the folks that said they would sponsor that would still be willing to do that. So we'll revisit that a couple months down the road as we get towards spring.
Mr. Chairman, Officer Schmidt, he's retired now.
Dave, yes, sir.
Dave, and he used to, at least when he was active in the neighborhoods there, he went over the top all the time. He did extra jobs, but he did clean up things about twice a year. He got volunteers that go through the alleys and everything else.
But let's just focus on the chief so he can.
I think we'll do that as part of our spring. We'll have our community policing guys in that area.
The neighborhood groups, that might be a good project for them. So maybe we can introduce that for a neighborhood association.
That is, well, yeah. But they do, I know they do clean up, so that's, I think we can attack this from multiple sources, multiple ways.
Yes, sir.
Done. Okay.
Any other questions?
Nope.
Anything else, Chief?
No, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Good job. Is there anyone here who would like to speak on this issue? Well, motion to open the floor by Alder Dorf.
Second.
Alder Galvin, all in favor? Aye.
All right.
State your name and address, please.
I am Ben Smith, owner of Badger Liquor, 1047 West Mason. This is, I guess this is a good idea with everything that we're given, all this information. I think a big thing we have to look at is the alcoholism. Now, if this, if you guys, shoot this down, I'm not going to go celebrate because we know alcoholism is an issue that's out there regardless. But I think a good thing that we're doing though too is I think it goes hand in hand without giving out all those extra licenses too, like they're vetoing down. I think that's a good thing because that's you have less places now you have to worry about alcohol being served. know, for our community. And another thing is we have to, us business owners, we should have, there should be more pressure on us business owners to clean up our areas up around our stores. I don't think that's really being done very well with the empty bottles and stuff like that. It's like we need to take more people and take the initiative and clean up their areas. That's what a lot of this boils down to make everything look better. So, otherwise, I was very happy with the findings and anything else. Have any questions for me?
Any questions?
Well, may I ask you just a question about your store?
Sure.
You work at the store?
I own it, yes. And I've been there for over 20 years.
Hi. You know, my point is that places, liquor stores, if that's their main business,
exactly,
they have more responsible clientele. Mm-hmm. It's not low-paid people that are coming and going, different people all the time. You're paying attention to what you're doing and enforcing
exactly
things. When you have constant turnover of help, which a lot of the convenience places do,
exactly,
and the stores, it's my sense that I would prefer to have alcohol in the inner city restricted to really just liquor stores and people that their whole livelihood is.
But please, just questions.
And with the no sellers too, we're on top of that. We're on those other big stores. You have all these new employees all the time that have to worry about that. I can probably recognize about 3/4 of people on the no sell list. I could tell you everything about them.
You know, the second they try to come in.
Yes, I do.
And do they stop coming in then?
Yes, they do. Well, or you see them around the corner trying to get someone, you have to kick them out, say you're going to call the police on them. You know, you try not to. You know, the last thing we want to do is, you know, you don't want to cause a police call, obviously. So you want to get them to move on, you know, you don't want to serve them, obviously, because a lot of times they're not drunk, a lot of times they are drunk, but yeah, you try to kick them out, but they'll keep coming back. It's just usually the same person comes in back all the time.
But you control them.
Yes, we can control that. We can't get alcohol in their hands. We try to, but I mean, they could get it somewhere else too. They could go to the drug store down the street. I've seen that happen already. They got it from there after I turned them down already.
Anything else?
No, I have nothing else.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Motion to return to regular order of business.
Second.
Motion by Alder Dorff to return to order, seconded by Alder Gallen. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any other?
And first, I want to compliment the chief and the staff here. This was not an easy study. It's and you know, and like you said, it was a snapshot. The snapshot is indicative. It is larger than this. And I'm pleased with the work they did. And I'm so happy to have our chief on board here. I hope he stays here for a long time because everything he puts his hand to is efficient and good. And I really appreciate it. So I'd like to start out with that. I think the whole committee doesn't feel differently. But to the subject of this, maybe it's more the sale of alcohol in the inner city rather than the single serve. But of course, the people who want single serve are these people. They're the ones that maybe they dug up some change or whatever it is, and if they're being turned away, if we could depend that all of the shops would really honor that no serve list, and we add it to all of them, it'd be a great help. But when you have a lot of different help all the time that don't know who people are, as one of the gentlemen, you know, the gentleman just spoke to us, you know, he's there, he sees it, he knows who they are, and he knows how to turn them away. But if there was a different person working there every 3 months, every 6 months, or whatever, they are not going to get that institutional knowledge of who the losers are and who the people they shouldn't be serving. As he said, they're not always drunk when they walk in. They're looking to get something to get it. And I guess they'll go anywhere, any place, or something to try to do it. But I think the less we let them be a nuisance in the inner neighborhood, inner city neighborhoods, and that's where the problems are. It's not people coming home from work, picking up something at the store and going home. It's people that are on the loose, walking around. So I'm looking for help from the committee on anything that would help limit that. I think the chief's program is good. I think the last thing we want to do is raise the budget, but probably the single sale wouldn't do it all by itself. But I think...
Well, that's our agenda item, so let's just focus on that part of it right now.
Okay.
What is your feeling on the single serve? Is that something you want to go forward with or put on hold or is even placed on file?
I really feel that we should prohibit the sale of single cells from convenience store type operations in the inner city, because I just don't, unless they can prove that they've had, you know, employees, long-term employees and good records, I don't know. I you know instinctively, if you review online, or you don't want your neighborhoods deteriorating where these kind of places become popular places to go to get your booze. And we're not like quite a big city yet, but we're getting pretty big. I mean, the kind of crimes we see occurring here in the last 10 years are very different from 40 years ago. I mean, it was a quiet, family-oriented city that, not that we didn't have drunkards, we did. We had probably more bars than any, I guess, anybody in the state per capita. But I really feel if we're serious about it, we've got to cut down the access to it in the areas that we know there's problems. So if you want to put this off and combine it with our study of whether we're going to put them in the inner city, allow liquor at all, because that would, you know, if we're going to eliminate from the inner city, we don't have to talk about single serve. But I think I'd like to, with your permission, Mr. Chairman, just to refer this to our larger study, and let's see what our decision is about if we're going to allow liquor in the inner cities, which is my main concern. I'm not concerned out on Huron Road somewhere. But the less of alcohol access you have in those areas, the more likely they're going to become stronger neighborhoods, in my opinion. But it's the older areas where lower income people or homeless people tend to congregate. And anything we can do to cut down their access to alcohol, you know, hard alcohol, I think the better. So with that, I'd make a motion to refer this to our larger discussion at a future meeting.
I'll second that. Any further discussion? I'd just like to say I think that's appropriate, and I'm all in favor of that. But I do feel this basically is a homelessness issue, and I believe addressing homelessness is going to be more productive than addressing alcohol. Alcohol is but part of the issue, and I think we've taken some steps to address that. And I know starting January, New Camp will be here with they've got a permanent housing program started. They're going to house our 45 most needy homeless. I don't know if these people are on it. This would be interesting to double check with Alexi Wood. She would be part of the process of determining who those people are. And I'd like to see what kind of effect that has, getting the homeless off the street. Because that may be a big, you know, solve a big part of the problem right there. So I'm all for putting this off, and making it part of our bigger study, looking at that, and also looking at that time, homelessness, how things have changed, and how well the program, the community policing has evolved. So that's my take on it. Anything else we can, oh, yes?
Well, I think it has to be larger than that, and you've kind of spoken to it. I mean, just because you put homeless alcoholics into shelter doesn't mean they're going to stop drinking.
And not a shelter, it's permanent, they'll have their own homes.
I understand, but their own home is not going to stop them from drinking.
No, but
and
what
I'm trying to work at the county level, we used to have a long-term mental health facility at Brown County, and that has disappeared, I think, under Ms. Kelso when she was the county executive. But we see with the problems of having to build the jail, the number of mentally ill people, which includes alcoholics, etc., in it, I think we're working toward, our mental health task force is working toward hoping to get a longer-term facility. There's only three in the whole state of Wisconsin: Mendota, Truckloe County, and Winnebago. And, you know, those are not always, they aren't even the alcohol It's only if the alcohol adds, is combined with mental illness. But I think we need facilities that will allow for a longer program to rehabilitate people. Because you just don't dry them out and send them back on the street. You send them back to the drinking. They need their culture changed and need their help. Some people you're never going to help. They don't want help, and that's all there is to it. But there are others that I think can change. So,
if I may, that is what the permanent housing program does. Those people are off the street for good. They're not put in the facility. There's one social worker for every 15. Hang on, let me finish. There's one social worker for every 15 clients. And they are, and these programs have been in place in counties around us, Marinette, Outagamie, O'Connell, and they have been quite successful in getting homeless off the street into permanent housing. And once it's once they're in that safe zone, and it's not only addiction but mental health, those issues can start being addressed in a positive way. They feel safe, they feel less stress, and they can start dealing with their issues.
Is that going to be a condition of the health? Of the housing?
No, it's not. You don't want any conditions on it, because if you put conditions on it, you're setting people up for failure, and then they're out on the street. We want them off the street.
Is this so a facility?
The system is that they can, if they have an addiction,
they can drink at home.
They can drink at home.
It's
off the street.
It's a wet house, basically. It's something they've been doing similar to that out on all throughout the United States. And first time I heard about it, I thought, that's a bunch of BS. But the more I looked into it, the more I read into it. And then based on some of the programs that we tried to do in the city, we worked with the Mental Health Center and the NEW to identify the individuals that were the biggest calls for service as it related to alcohol overdoses. And we took 10 of those individuals. We tried to set them up in an apartment, get them jobs, even if it was just going to work for an hour a day, just the building block, and it didn't work out, because they really have to want to do it, and they have to change their culture, and I think if we could identify the top offenders, or not even offenders, but the people with the biggest needs, mental health, which usually results in the homelessness, identify them. And basically, this is what you're talking about. You're talking about the place that used to be out on towards Dykesville on 57. And before that, it was a stump farm out at the reforestation camp. Yes. So this is a more modernized facility than that was, with treatment as a key component. And this is something that I think if the county and the city and any other municipalities can all work together, identifying these individuals, getting them into these types of facilities, I think you would see a significant impact on our communities, all for the good.
Well, the judges have told us that, our mental health task force, our unanimous recommendation was that we needed some transitional housing, so I'm welcoming the program that they got a grant for. But the transitional housing, but the important part of it was, is that we needed treatment to go along with it.
Absolutely.
Otherwise it isn't going to work. Otherwise you're going to become a magnet for
right. Every
wino who wants a free place to live.
Well, that has not been the case in these programs that have been implemented elsewhere. And treatment is offered, but it's focused on the individual. It's not forced on them. They work at their own pace.
But right, it's
because if you force it on them, if you put it on a condition, you're setting them up for failure, and then they're back out on the street, and then we haven't solved anything.
But once they get into the system, the judges felt they needed a place to send them. They didn't want to send them back into the environment they were in,
right.
Whether it was mental health or alcohol and drug abuse, etc. But we do have a big vacuum. The longer term help to try to do something with the chronic problems.
Right. I think we're all kind of in agreement with what we want
to
accomplish here.
At some point in time, from maybe the city council or through this committee, that we support those efforts at the county level, because we kind of ran into a brick wall this year. We got some mental health programs put in place last year, $1,150,000 worth. And our goal this year was to step up the transitional housing. We felt that was the next step we needed to do. And of course, we are looking at, shouldn't Brown County perhaps be a longer, find ways to make it a long-term facility so that when we find people that we can work with, that we can keep them in a program long enough that they'll succeed.
Right, and that's what I think, if I understand Randy correctly, this thing he's talking about would be a long-term
yes.
treatment facility.
Well,
it's not,
not facility,
facility.
But treatment's available. It's not, but it's the purpose of it is to get people off the street. Once people are off the street, you're going to be more successful in treating them than trying to treat them when they're on the street. So the first step is to get people off the street, which is not only good for them, it's good for the community. From once you got them off the street, then you try to work with them to deal with their issues. But it's at their pace. It has to be at their pace, or you're setting them up for failure, and then they're back out on the street, and you haven't helped them, and you haven't helped the community.
So.
Well, we're looking at as an alternative to jail.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what we're
right. Yeah. I agree with Alderdorf here. It's time to take vote. The yes, motion was made to refer this item into our larger moratorium discussion. Of alcohol in the inner city. Was it at the inner city, or was that? That was citywide at first.
It was all wide open.
Wide open, yeah.
My interest is the inner city.
Right, but that was the original agenda item, so we'll make it part of that. We can address it at that time. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That motion carries. I'll
motion
take a
to adjourn.
Motion
second.
To adjourn by Alder Dorf, seconded by Alder Galvin. All in favor?
Aye.
Not me.